A very warm good morning to all of the participants on this 8th day of GST certification course hosted by Hiragangai Academy. On this 8th day, we are going to have sessions on returns under GST law and the genesis of disputes and its mitigation. The first session, being GST returns, would be covered by the eminent faculty CA Akshay Hiragangai. About the speaker, he is a qualified chartered accountant in the year 2016. He is currently a partner designate in Hiragangai Associates. He is in the process of completing his DISA course. He has experience of more than three years in audits. He is also a member of powerful study circle Akshara at Hiragangai Associates. He is a regular contributor to replies and GST articles on CA Club India, Tax Guru, and so on. With this brief introduction, I like to welcome CA Akshay Hiragangai for taking up this session. Welcome, Akshay. Kindly take up the session forward.
Thank you, Arjun. Hope I am audible to everyone. Good morning, everyone. And today we'll be discussing on the GST returns and the use of checklist. Because we cannot have a physical session today, we will take all the questions at the end, which will be taken up in the through the chat box. And whosoever questions are not answered live, their questions will be answered through email separately. So with this, we will start the session. The topic given is the returns under GST, use of checklist, and also I have covered a few common errors in relation to the GST returns and reconciliations that are important during this entire process. So we have also included the recent due date extensions, relaxations that the government has provided due to the COVID lockdown, and also gone in depth in relation to GSTR 1 and 3B being the main returns which are there on a monthly basis for most of the assessees. Now coming to the due dates. Due dates as such, GSTR 1, as we all know, is the 11th of the next month. GSTR 2A will be auto-populated once the GSTR 1 is filed. The GSTR 4 is 18th of the next quarter. 5th is the 20th or the 7th of the registered person. GSTR 6 is the 13th of the next month. GSTR 7 is the 10th of the next month. And 8, which is the TCS, is for the 10th of the next month. And 9 is the 31st of the December of the next financial year. Now, this is just a brief detail. Why have not included GSTR 3B? The reason is because the GSTR 3B is staggered, the due dates. So they have divided the due dates between the persons who have a turnover above 5 crores and those below 5 crores. And within the persons who are below 5 crores, they have staggered it between two. There are few states, the metropolitan states, which are on 22nd of the next succeeding month, and the balance states, which is 24th. All those assessees who have a turnover more than 5 crores will remain to be 20th of the succeeding month. So now let's dive right into the extensions and relaxations given by the authorities recently. Now, from this origin of GST till date, we have seen multiple extensions, most of which are due to portal issues. GSTR 1, now, for the period March, April and May 2020, and for those who are filing GSTR 1 on a quarterly basis ending 31st March, there will not be any late fees up to 30th June 2020. The late fees have been waived off. Also, there was a restriction in relation to claiming of credit in the GSTR 3B based on the credit which is reflecting in GSTR 2A. Now that has been relaxed. So this has not been waived off, it is only relaxed. So what they mean to say is for the period February to August 2020, you do not need to take the ITC based on the GSTR 2A. Rather, you need to consider it on a cumulative basis in the month of September 2020. I have a few other points in relation to the ITC in relation to GSTR 2A, which I'll be taking up in the later slides. GSTR 3B for May 2020 has been extended. So this, like I said, there are three staggered dates. So 27th June will be for the those persons more than 5 crore turnover, and 12th and 17th July is for those with less than 5 crore turnover. So next is the due dates for the period Feb, March and April 2020. Here it is important to note that the due date has not been extended. I'll repeat, the due date has not been extended. The only change that has taken place is the government has waived off the interest in relation to if there is a delay in filing such returns. So from the due date, actual due date, if you do not file the returns for 15 days, the interest for such 15 days is still waived off. Now, if you file the, say, if we will take an example, 5th May is the due date, which will happen if 15 days are added to 20th April of the March filing return. So 20th April being March 2020 GSTR 3B due date, 5th May is 15 days from such date. If you file it within such period, there will not be any interest in late fees. If you file between 5th May to 30th June, the interest will be calculated at 9% per annum for that period only. Now, if we will come to the period that if you file a return after 30th June 2020, in such case, the waiver of interest which has been provided will not apply. You will have to pay full interest and late fees, and the rate of interest also will be higher, which is the normal rate at 18%. To clarify, net interest only should be applicable. This is not clarified in the notifications, but through recent decisions and rulings and even the update by the government, the interest will be calculated only on net basis and not on gross. By net, I mean the interest will be applicable only on cash payable and not on the ITC accumulated in your GST portal. So now one important point which needs to be understood is, if I have sufficient ITC credit presently and I do not file my returns because there is no concept of interest applicable to me, yes, this can be taken as a option. But remember, if you do not file your returns in time, you have a possibility to obtain a show cause notice from the department. And also, if you do not file for a considerable period of time, the e-way bill portal also can be blocked for such an SSE. So the concept of interest and filing of return should not be taken to such a far extent that you do not file the returns itself. So next, the other extensions are in relation to the existing composition dealers. For the year ending 31st March 2020, the due date has been extended to 15 July 2020. Option to file for a new composition scheme. A person who was not under composition scheme wants to get into the composition scheme for financial year 2021. The earlier you had to file before 31st March. Now that has been extended to 30th June 2020 through form CMP02. And the details which you have to give of the credit through form ITC03, you can file by 31st July 2020. These are all extensions which are given due to the present situation. Validity of... Yes, Arjun.
Yeah, one of the requests from the participant, can you make it in the presentation view? So presently it is in slide view. Below, if you can make it presentation view.
Okay.
They can read it. Okay.
Is it clear now?
Ah.
Yeah, thanks. So next is next point is on the validity of e-way bills. So those e-way bills which expired, which means they were already raised, but they expired on 20th March, between the period 20th March and 15th April. They are deemed to be extended until 30th April 2020. So this is only a relaxation procedure. There is no real clarification on the what happens to whether we need to raise EV bills for this period and how they need to be considered. Arjun, do you have any information on that?
Actually, I didn't got it. Can
EV
you...
bill? EVA bills which need to be raised, what is the position in law on that?
A position in law, the one evaluation which we can do is, since notification 35 gives the procedural compliance relaxation till 30th June, so we can think whatever EVA bill which we have raised previously, the validity may extend till we can keep that validity till 30th June. However, for new movement, only for restricted movement we can raise EVA bills, because not all the movements have been allowed by the government.
Yes,
there is no specific clarity in the law relating to that.
Okay, so yeah, even I have the same concept that we do not have a clarity in relation to the fresh EVA bills. All right, then we'll go to the next GSTR 6 and GSTR 7. 6 being the ISD returns and 7 being the tax deducted at source, which is generally done by the governmental authorities. So both these returns have been extended up to 30th June 2020. For TCS filers, that is the e-commerce related parties, the PMT08 payment form has been extended up to 7 July for the period ending 31st March. So that concludes our extensions and the relaxations that have been provided by the government. Now I just wanted to bring some information in relation to the new returns, because this was proposed maybe 2 years back, but presently it is still in abeyance. It had come in the 27th General GST Council meeting, and recently it was extended to be implemented from October 2020. So I'll just take a few important key features, which is the differences between the present returns and the new returns. So in the new returns, you need to have an even more detailed system in your maintained as your books of accounts. I mean to say that your HSN details, for example, presently in your GSTR1, you're not giving line wise or invoice wise HSN details. Now that is an additional requirement in the new returns. You will have to track the cases where the vendors have not filed the returns for more than 2 months, but you have taken the credit. And if you have not claimed if you have claimed such credit and the vendor has not filed, you will have to add it back as your outward supply with 2 months with the interest component. Also, you will have to give the details of such vendors with their GST numbers and the invoice details. This will help the government to track such non-compliant vendors. And another very important change which is expected in the new returns is that the GSTR 2A, similar form to GSTR 2A, which will come, it will be a return which will be auto populated based on the data which has been filed by vendors, but it will not be a dynamic return. So GSTR 2A presently is a dynamic return. That means if I file today some details on my GSTR1 and I have not filed the return for that month, after a month I can still include details in that GSTR1 and I can file such return, and it will auto-populate for the recipient in such month. So this issue is creating a lot of difficulty for the recipients to do a matching of their ITC correctly in the present scenario. But this will be eradicated once the new returns come into picture, because they will give a forced stop. That means once all the returns are filed by 10th, by 11th, whatever details has been filed will be considered for such month. If any details are uploaded after that date, those informations will be considered in the next period. So this will be easy to track and keep a track of the vendors who are also filing in a delayed manner. So these are the two main important points I wanted to bring up, which will probably come up in the new returns. Although the practical scenario looks like it will come only from the financial year 2021. So in relation to new returns, to get ready for the new returns, two things are very important. Because credit will be linked to your vendor's filing, there may be a revision in payment terms which will be required. Another thing is systems and softwares should be aligned, which means your books of accounts should be in a manner to throughout the report which is required for the new returns. Also, considering the introduction of the e-invoicing for those people who it is applicable to, this will also be very important that your systems and softwares are aligned to the GST law. So now I'll get into the GSTR 3B. We have about 75 slides totally. So I will go a little faster through the GSTR 3B and GSTR 1 so that I can get into the common errors and the reconciliations required, and also touch upon the use of a checklist. So here the new features which are made available. By new features, I think by now you would have already got used to these features. If you file a CGST or an SGST, the other tax amount will get auto-filled. This had earlier caused problems because of typing errors in the GST returns. You can also save the form before confirming the details, and you can view them at a later time. Preview form or download, which can be used as a cross verification to your books of accounts. So there was earlier a concept of once you submit, you cannot unfreeze the data. As of now, there is no submit function. After you have put all the data, there is only a proceed to pay option in the GSTR 3B. So they have done away with this submit function, which was causing some difficulty for the SSCs. So you can change the details in the table. So this is in relation to the submit process itself. And when you go to the payment sheet, if you hover over the ITC tabs, you will be able to see the balance in the ledgers. So this is a useful function for those who can directly, if they are utilizing their entire ITC, they can just hover over the tab and input the entire details. Once you put in, say you have a balance of 1,000 rupees and you input the ITC balance of 1,000, once you have done that, the balance will show as nil, which will also be a checking mechanism to ensure that you have not made any typing errors. So there is also a system suggested credit utilization, which will already be auto-populated based on the portal. Now here we have noticed after the new rule 88A came for utilization of credit, that this may not be the optimum way of utilizing your credit. So it is always suggested to ensure that before you take the auto-filled credit utilization method, recheck once with your calculation to see whether both are matching. So other than that, the others are very simple ones. You can go through it separately. Recently, there was some information on the fact that the persons will be allowed to file through EVC for those who are required to file through DSC. So here, Arjun, is there a notification for this? Because I was not able to find this. But I have got the information that those who are unable to file through DSC can file through EVC for this period. Okay, so next thing that we'll need to get into is, this is a basic step which is required to file your GST 3B. So these are the questions which have to be answered before you can start filing the GST returns. So those who have to file a nil return, if they put yes, all the other tabs are, it cannot be selected. And what happens is, once you put nil return and next, it automatically takes you to the filing sheet. So this is basically to ease the difficulty for the common man. So here, most of the people will not be clicking on option number C. That is, have you made interstate supplies to unregistered persons, compensation tax pay persons, or UIN holders? So table 3.2 is a subset of table 3.1. The reason people do not file table C is because it does not have any tax impact. But please note, if you're not informing the department of these details, they are unable to transfer the tax amounts to those respective states, due to which they are able to put a penalty on you for maybe say 50,000 based on the general penalty clause. So not providing information which is readily available can also cost you. Table D, of course, is your ITC details, table 4. And again, table E, which has your nil rated exempt and non-GST supplies. Again, this does not have a tax impact per se, but it has to be disclosed. Interest and late fees. Late fees generally is auto-calculated by the GSTR 3B. So if you file delayed return for this month, the late fees will be auto-populated in the next GSTR 3B. So this is a format of your GSTR 3B. If you click on the details, this is what it looks like. So coming into your GSTR 3B format, this is GSTR table 3.1. So like I said, if you put any amount in CGST or SGST, the other value gets auto-populated. Here, all the values have to be keyed in by the assessee. Now, for example, I have keyed in 1000 and I by mistake put 1000, I wanted to put 1 lakh. So I need to add two more zeros. So here I can't just click on it and add two more zeros. So what happens is, if you need to delete any item, you need to remove the two zeros which are there after the decimal. So this typing error is being made on a regular basis by many assessees. So this is something that we all need to take care of. Now, table 3.1 also includes inward supplies liable to reverse charge. So this details will be coming from your liability which arises based on section 9353 or even some URD supplies which are applicable generally to the real estate sectors. So here we have just given a basic understanding of how a GSTR 3B has to be worked upon before it is put into the GST portal. So you take your invoices details, you add the debit notes, you reduce the credit notes. If there are any advances, generally now advances are applicable only in relation to services and not goods. So add the GST on advances which have been received and any advances which have been adjusted. So this is a basic understanding of what value this rupees 1,12,500 will be considered in table 3.1.A in the GSTR 3B. Next is the 3.2 table. Well, like I said, this is very important to be filed by the registered persons if they do not want to have issues on with the department in relation to suppression of information. So this is the table 4 in relation to ITC. Import of goods details, that is in relation to your goods which have come from non-taxable territory. You will always have a bill of entry in relation to this item which will be available in your ICE gate portal. This does not auto-populate in your GSTR 2A. Import of services also does not auto-populate in your GSTR 2A. This is a liability which will probably be under RCM, which you would have already paid in the GSTR 3B table 3. So the same values can probably be imported here, other than the point which will be coming in point number 3, which is inward supplies liable to reverse charge. So 2 plus 3, if you say table number 4, A, 2 and 3 will add up to the table number 31D. So this is a check mechanism which you can input in your GST returns to ensure that whatever reverse charge has been paid, the credit has been claimed in the same month. Please note, if there are any ineligible credits, those should not be claimed. Next is the inward supplies from ISD. Data, you can base it on the GSTR 6A which comes to you. That data can be utilized for claiming such credit. ITC reversed as per rule 42 and 43. This is generally in relation to all those exempt and non-GST supplies which may be there as part of your outward supplies, against which you need to reverse any directly eligible credits and also the common credits. So with that, you will get a net ITC which is available, which will auto-populate for utilization of your payment of tax. Now, ineligible ITC, that is as per section 17.5. Now, this is separate from table A, B, and C. So, what it means, the ineligible credit should not be included in table A or B. It should be separately disclosed in table D. So, we will go through some of the eligible credits and blocked credits which are there as a major issues which are there in the GST portal, GST law presently. So, food and beverages, outdoor catering, beauty treatment, health services, your cosmetic and plastic surgery, life health insurance, rent a cab. So, all these are blocked credits under section 17.5 of the GST law. Here, we need to ensure that there are some exceptions to be able to take the credit. So, where you are using it to provide a same category of outward taxable supply, you will be eligible for such credit if such ITC has been is there in your books of accounts. So, it should be as part of your outward liability. Also, even if it is not part of your outward liability, but there is an obligation for the employer to provide such services to the employee, then that will also be eligible for credit. Now, for this, we can take an example, two examples I can give you. One is in relation to the outdoor catering. That means, as per the Factories Act, there is a requirement of those factories which have more than 250 workers to provide a catering activity to such employees. So, when this is liable under law, we can take the credit of such outdoor catering, whatever is being charged by the vendor. Another one is the EDLI. This is something which many people may not have thought about. EDLI is your equity deposit linked insurance scheme. So, this is mandatory for those persons who are liable to pay the provident fund. So, those who have provident fund will have to take the EDLI. So, whatever premium is paid against this insurance, there is also a GST element in this value. That GST element can be claimed as a credit. There are some clarifications which also I would like to give. Life and health insurance are the only insurances which are disallowed. So, other insurances, the credit on such insurances can be claimed. A few of them being gratuity insurance can be claimed. You can also claim on your stock, your building, liability insurance. So, all business related insurances can be claimed. And even employee related, like I said, gratuity can be claimed, but it should not be life or health insurance. So, I have given a few information on the eligible and ineligible credits, but I would not like to get into this now. If we have time, we will circle back around to this data. Similarly, I've also given a basic apportionment of your ITC. So, if it is used for taxable and exempted products, then how are you supposed to apportion your ITC in relation to Rule 42 and 43? Please note, even if you have exempted supplies, but they are actually exported, then such credit also still can be claimed because they are zero rated supplies and the credit is eligible. So with this, here we have a values of exempt, nil rated and non-GST inward supplies. Please note, this is on the inward supplies. This is also one table which is not being filled by most of the SSEs. Here again, it does not have any tax impact, but again, the department, if they feel the need, they could file a general penalty for not providing information to the authorities. So what I will do, the GSTR1 outward return, I'll just give you the brief of how the GSTR1 is being auto-populated for the purpose of filing the returns. So first thing is taxation based. So you have taxable supplies separately, you have exempted supplies separately. Customer based. You have a registered person supplies, your B2B table, and you have B2C tables. In B2C, you have a B2C large and B2C others. Large is only for those interstate supplies more than 2.5 lakhs. level of detailing. So here you have an invoice wise and consolidated. Invoice wise is used for your B2B and consolidated is used for B2C. Here it is important to note that the credit note and debit note need not be shown separately for B2C. They have to be netted off and then disclosed based on your place of supply. Next is your destination base, that is your interstate supplies and your intrastate. So IGST and CGST, CGST, SGST. An option called reverse charge. So in for reverse charge, you have an option to disclose yes or no in the B2B table. So forward charge. Now I have many tables in relation to GSTR1, but as there is not too much time available, I have only an hour left. I will come back to these details as they are not very difficult to understand, and most of the people filing GSTR1 would already have experienced this these details. So we'll take up the more important details and then we'll come back to this if we have time. So yeah, I would like to touch upon one important aspect, which is circular 26/2017. This had come out in 29 December 2017. So the basic crux of this circular is, if you are unable to make any changes in the GSTR 1 and 3B, because there is no revision of returns allowed. Earlier in service tax there was a revision of returns, but now revision of returns are not allowed. So how do I correct any mistakes, omissions, errors which I have made in my previous returns? So that has been taken care through circular 26. So here what they are trying to say is, any errors, omissions, mistakes made are to be corrected in the subsequent returns. So here we have given an illustration of what the error could be, and here you can, for example, we'll take the second one. The first one is a situation where there are no variances between GSTR 3B and GSTR 1. The second situation is where the GSTR 1 is higher than the GSTR 3B. So here, based on circular 26, in your next GSTR 3B, you can include this 50,000 and 4,500 CGST and SGST each in your next GSTR 3B while filing the returns. But please note, interest would be liable for delay in payment of tax. Here, one thing which most of the participants will be thinking is, I came to know my mistake immediately after filing my GSTR 1 and had already filed my GSTR 3B. But now I want to pay the 4,500, 9,000 rupees of tax and not pay the interest on the same. So here, what I would like to suggest is, where the value is very high and the interest cost is coming to a significant amount, suggest you to pay the liability through DRC03, where you can pay this amount in the next GSTR 3B and not pay separately through DRC03. That option can be considered. So considering the significance of interest amount, this decision may be taken. So next is this situation which is turned around, where your GSTR 3B is higher and GSTR 1 is low. Assume that you have missed to include certain details in GSTR 1. You can surely include them in the next GSTR return, GSTR 1. So that's what has been explained here in the next slides. Now we will come to the reconciliations. So now, the major burning situation, that is the reconciliation between GSTR 3B and 2A in relation to ITC that has to be claimed. So relaxation which has been provided for February to August with the condition that you have to consider all of them on a cumulative basis in the GST return of September 2020. So brief understanding of what is Rule 36.4. So what they are saying is you can claim the eligible credit which is arising out of GSTR 2A. Please note they mean only eligible credit, not the entire credit in GSTR 2A. For the period October to December, you are allowed to take an ad hoc additional credit of 20% if your credit in your books of accounts was higher than your GSTR 2A. That 20% has been reduced to 10% from Jan 2020 onwards. Now, there are many discussions on whether this Rule 36.4 itself is valid. It is invalid in the law. Now, the reasons being Section 43A, which has not yet been notified, which is under the Act and not rules, has not yet been notified. GSTR 2A is a dynamic return, like I said earlier. How can the assessee be expected to auto-populate on a monthly basis and on a year-to-date basis for each return in the time which is available? There is a legal maxim which summarizes that anything which is impossible cannot be expected from the assessee. So this kind of a concept may be applied and can be said that the department cannot expect us to do this when
hello. I think we are facing a little technical issue. Akshay?
Yeah.
I think your audio is breaking in between. If the bandwidth is lesser, you can switch off your video and then you can continue. So there will be a continuous flow of audio.
Okay. So can you hear me now?
Yeah. Clear now.
What was the last thing that you heard?
Regarding 36.4, when you have started 36.4, relating to that 43A, whatever you have discussed from the introduction, that we your audio got lost.
Okay, so section 43A, which was introduced in the Act but not yet notified, this is in clear contravention to Rule 36.4. That is, when the Act itself has not yet been notified, how is the provision for restriction of ITC being introduced through a rule? So this is something that can be challenged. GSTR 2A is a dynamic return. That is, any changes which are done by the vendors, I will not be able to know when they have made the change and for which period they have made the change. So here it is very difficult to follow through on the reconciliation between GSTR 2A and 3B. The most possible and optimum way of reconciliation is I do it on a monthly basis and I also do it on a year-to-date basis. When I say year to date, let us take 2019 and 20 for example. I will take the GSTR 2A, which is auto-populated from April 2019 till date. I will re-download on as on date all these data, and I will put up all the remove all the ineligible credits from 2A, and then do a reconciliation to my ITC as per books of accounts. This will give me a complete picture of the credit which is displaying in my GSTR 2A. So the requirement to do it only on a monthly basis is, I can say, is insufficient. And actually, to get a clear picture, you need to do it on a year-to-date basis. Next is the challenge which can be made is doing these kind of procedures is very difficult for the common man on a monthly basis. Every month downloading all the reports for the entire year and then doing the bifurcation of eligibility, ineligibility, and then getting all of them together is very difficult. So there is a legal maxim which says that anything which is impossible cannot be expected, and that can be depended upon. Next is in relation to section 16 and 17. The eligibility of credit is based on four major conditions. That is, you should have the proper invoice, you should have received the goods and services, the return should be filed, and also the payment should be made. Now, this payment should be made can be interpreted as payment should be made by the vendor also to the government. And that is the basis on which they're saying the rule 36.4 is to be considered. Now here, if it is reflecting in your GSTR 2A, and it is also you have made the payment, you have all the proper invoices, and you're satisfying all the conditions. But the issue which remains is the GSTR 2A has been filed in a delayed fashion by the vendor. That means the credit is in relation to January 2020, but he has filed his GSTR 2A in, say, August 2020. Now, am I eligible to the credit? And if yes, when am I eligible to the credit? As per Rule 36.4, you are eligible to the credit only in August 2020. Many people will be asking, now that there is no requirement to do the GSTR 2A to claim credit for the period of Feb to August 2020, can I claim whatever credit which I have, which was earlier not claimed because of this rule? Here, one thing I would like to point out is, for the period whichever GSTR 2A, that is the vendors who have not filed their returns, ensure that they at least file it by August 2020. If you are claiming any credit which will not reflect in GSTR 2A, when you do it on a consolidated cumulative basis in September 2020, you will again have to reverse such credit with interest. So that is a risk which you will take if you claim credit which is not reflecting in GSTR 2A. So although they have relaxed the option to claim the credit, what they may be relaxing is that you will not get the notices which are flying around presently. But the requirement to follow up with your vendors and ensure that the returns are filed is not being relaxed. You will still have to follow up with them to ensure that at a later stage, you will not be faced with a notice. So the baseline which we need to consider now is the GSTR 1 for the period up to August 2020, ensure all your vendors are filing such credits by September 2020. So the next type of reconciliations, which I assume most of the persons will be taking care of, is your GSTR 3B versus 1. So presently now GSTR 1 is to be filed first and then the GSTR 3B. So GSTR 1, when you're filing, it is always suggested to reconcile those with your books of accounts. If you have to reconcile with your books of accounts, the books for such month should be final. Being final, I mean, you should include a cutoff date and backdated entries should not be allowed. Once you do this, matching books to GSTR 1 will be simple. And once the GSTR 1 is final, then include consolidating such details for GSTR 3B will be very easy. And if this formula is taken care of, ensuring books are finalized before filing GST returns, your annual return and your audit will go very smoothly. And by that I mean you can negotiate the price with your consultants too. So if the books are maintained well and there are good cutoff dates in which are included, it will be a very easy and simple process without the headache that we are all seeing presently. So type two again is your tax reconciliations. So this again is similar to your income reconciliation. Earlier it was in relation to taxable value. Type two is in relation to your taxes itself. And type three, which is in relation to ITC. Here again, the first requirement is to match books to GSTR 3B. Then match 2A to 3B. Here, whatever credit is not being claimed on account of the new rule 36.4, that has to be tracked separately in a separate Excel file, so that you can verify at a later stage if it has been filed by the vendor in his GSTR 1, and then you can claim such credit in that subsequent GSTR 3B. So this is something you need to keep a separate track of to ensure that you don't miss out on credit because of the new rule. So this is just a simple display of the GSTR 1 versus 3B, which most of the third party websites will be providing. So here, one more important aspect that I would like to consider is your electronic cash ledger. So cash paid in your GSTR 3B table, your first cash payable will be applied towards your RCM liability, and because that payment is being made in cash only. So what we need to take care is any liability which is there, interest will be applicable on cash payable. That was already discussed on the net liability, net interest concept. So if you have any RCM liabilities for the month, but you have sufficient ITC balance for outward liabilities, your RCM liabilities will not be relaxed. You will still have to pay interest on that liability. Again, here we would like to emphasize on the closing balance of your books should be matching to the closing balance after you file your GST returns for the month. So this is a reconciliation process which will be taking place after filing of the returns. So first, the process of filing, doing reconciliations before, that is before you file returns, you do your outward liability, taxes and ITC books to GSTR 1 and GSTR 3B. After you file the returns, you'll also have to do a reconciliation of the closing balance as per books, which is your cash and credit balance, and also the closing balance as per the portal. This will give you a complete reconciliation of the data, which will be matching to your books of accounts. So here we have just taken a simple, in case of a difference, what are the actions that have been, which have to be taken? So if you have an excess liability disclosed in the returns, what do you need to do? If you are following the circular, you can ensure that such liability is reduced from the next month's GSTR 3B. Please note, if it is a excess liability disclosed but not adjusted in any of the subsequent GSTR 3Bs and the time limit is already passed, that is the September of the next financial year is passed, then the only option is to go for a refund separately. Please note, the concept of unjust enrichment has to be taken care if you are going for a refund for excess liability disclosed. If you have only disclosed the liability, excess liability in GSTR 1, but taxes have been paid correctly in GSTR 3B, again, either you make the change through circular 26, that is in the next GSTR 1. If you have not made the change, in your annual return, disclose the correct liability. Income which has not been disclosed in the returns, here again, disclose in the next GSTR 3B, or here you have an option of disclosing the liability in the GSTR 9 and paying the appropriate interest. Please note, when you are discharging liability through GSTR 9, you will have to pay through cash only. So another option before filing GSTR 9, which may be discussed, is filing the liability through DRC 03 separately and claiming the and utilizing the ITC, if any, for payment of such additional undisclosed income. Excess credit available in the returns. Excess credit availed in the returns. Here, what I can understand by excess credit is, it is credit which is not eligible, or you have taken a single credit twice, double availment. So in these cases, interest will be applicable and it has to be corrected in the subsequent financial, subsequent GSTR returns, 3B. If you are unable to do that between in the timelines, this can be included in the GSTR 9, and there you can ensure that it is paid through DRC 03 in cash. Next is the credit reversals on account of exempt supplies. So this is something that most of the persons will miss. Exempt supplies are not just those which are exempted based on the notifications which are available for goods and services. It could also mean those non-GST supplies, that is your liquor, petrol, diesel, which have presently been kept outside the levy of GST, and as per the definitions, now will be included for the purpose of exempt supplies. It would also include securities, such as your mutual fund trading or equity shares trading, the trading which is happening, you will have to consider 1% of the sale value as the exempt supply for the purpose of credit reversal. Although Schedule 3 items are not included for the purpose of ITC reversal, land sale, that is immovable property sale, will be considered for the purpose of reversal of ITC. So these are some important tips to be considered while doing a credit reversal based on your Rule 42 and 43. The format for Rule 42 and 43 for reversal of ITC is different. So that has to be taken care of while reversing the credits. And some of the other differences in relation to advance and financial credit note, debit note. So these are something which can be taken care of. If there are any specific doubts in relation to advance or financial credit notes and debit notes, please do write to us and we can take them on a specific basis. Next is the reconciliation of documents issued during the period. So documents have to be disclosed in GSTR 1 in the documents tab. Many people I have seen are not updating this table at all. And even if they are updating, they are not updating clearly. That is, payment vouchers are not being updated, refund vouchers are not being updated, receipt vouchers not being updated, and also reverse charge, self-invoice which is being raised in relation to reverse charge is not being updated. Also, delivery challans and relation to movement of goods without tax or for job work. These documents are not being updated, which can again relate to a suppression of information, and the department may have an ability to raise a notice for you for payment of penalty. Here, now we are coming to the other reconciliations. Although the period to file TRAN credit was extended, it was extended mainly for those who had technical difficulties. It was extended up to 31st March, although now the time limit has been passed. So the requirement here is there are many people who are receiving notices for reversal of ineligible credit that has been claimed through transitional returns. Now that may not have been accounted in the system, or the TRAN credit which has been considered for the purpose of GST may not be carried forward correctly in the books of accounts. So there may be a difference in your closing balances in relation to TRAN credit, which can be verified. Now, in relation to the ITC availed, like I said, matching of the books to the GSTR 3B already discussed and the GSTR 2A. There is one which we need to consider in relation to the 180 days payment. So there is a clause which says that if you have not made the payment to your vendor within 180 days, then such credit has to be reversed. And if you are not reversed, if you have not made the payment within 180 days, then up to the time that you are reversing this credit, the interest will be applicable at 18%. So you can see Rule 37 for that interest component. But they've also given a provision that once you make the entire payment, you can reclaim the credit at any given date. The time limit will not apply in these cases. Important thing to consider is Rule 42, that is reversal of credit in relation to input and input services, has to be annually recomputed by the September of the month. So any additional reversal has to be considered before the September month, and any additional credit claim which is arising out of the annual recomputation has to be claimed by such date. If not claimed, the credit would lapse. Where you are doing this annual recomputation by September, and there is an additional credit reversal, the interest for such credit will apply from 1st April of the financial year. So please ensure that you are doing the reversals by the March return itself. Presently, as we all know, the due date has been extended for March 2020. So doing your annual recomputation for Rule 42 is suggested. Next is in relation to reverse charge. Check whether tax has been paid on all those supplies which attract reverse charge and RICO with your expenses. Here, one of the basic details that can be used to verify reverse charge is your form 15C and CB under your direct tax. Now, here, this will give you details of all the foreign expenses which have been made, which can give you a very simple detail of import of services which are liable under reverse charge. Please note, for those expenses where the place of supply falls outside India, there will not be a reverse charge liability. Other than this, there have been rent-a-cab has been introduced into the reverse charge recently. Your security has also been introduced in January 2019. GTA was always there. Legal expenses was always there. Sponsorship services was always liable under reverse charge. Now, these are some of the important ones which are liable under reverse charge, which has to be seen, gone through your expenses in your books of accounts, if you have such expenses, and verify whether you are liable to reverse charge. And once you make the reverse charge payment, ensure you are claiming the eligible credit. So now we will get into the common errors. I have about 15 common errors which are provided. Now, first one which we have already discussed is non-reconciliation before filing the GSTR 3B. So I'll go to the next one, incorrect ITC classification. So here, what I mean is, if you are not considering your eligible and ineligible credits correctly, a lot of people now, based on the new rule 36.4, are claiming credit directly based on GSTR 2A without considering the eligibility clauses under section 16 and 17. So this is a very big mistake being made. Also, I'll give a simple example. GSTR 2A has been filed by the vendor in the month of March, but you have received the goods and the invoice in the month of April. Now here, you will have to take the credit only in the month of April, as the eligibility arises then. So mistake being made is, the credit is being claimed in the month of March itself based on GSTR 2A. Sometimes the concept of eligibility and ineligibility also is not being verified, and directly credit is being claimed. Please note, interest can be applied at 24% for incorrect ITC claim. Suggestion. So the resolution for this error is, get a periodic review done to ensure that every credit that has been claimed can be rectified within a shorter period of time without having a departmental intervention, or have a monthly assistance set up for a few months to ensure that you learn how to do the get the process in place, and then which can be carried on by your employees. Next is the incorrect details in GSTR 1. So we have all seen many of the GSTIN numbers which are wrong. The invoice details which are given are incorrect. So there are only some special characters allowed in the invoice, and only up to a maximum of 16 characters are allowed in the invoice number. GSTN, again, valid GSTN has to be considered while filing the GSTR 1. A lot of people are facing issues while filing GSTR 1. They are getting incorrect GST number, then they have to go back to their vendors, customers, and ask them, what is your correct GST number, and then put it in B2B. Those who do not have time for this are directly uploading all these details in B2C, and later on they're facing difficulty from the vendor end, telling, why have you filed my details in B2C? I'm not able to see in GSTR 2A, therefore I'm holding your payment. This is a very common issue which is there in the industry right now. So filing a correct GSTR 1 becomes of paramount importance. And the customer onboarding process itself can be very useful, where you get the correct GSTN number and also verify it before the customer is completed his transaction. Point number four, like I said, non-disclosures of those which are not affecting taxes. So non-taxable inward supplies, 3.2 table of 3B, documents, exempt supplies, all these are mainly arising because it is not easily available for the persons who are filing the GSTR returns. So to enable this process, the accounting has to be streamlined to the requirement of the GST returns. Editing errors. Here, the issue which can arise is GSTR 3B, once you file, once you click on proceed to pay and it has been filed, you cannot go back and change the details. So many times, if there are errors in updating such details, then there will be a excess ITC or excess cash paid, which will lead to a cash flow issue for the company. So always ensure a maker checker policy, that is only one person does the preparation of the GST returns and it is reviewed by a higher authority before filing. Now, delay in filing GSTR 3B. This is already discussed. Filing of nil returns is not the solution when you do not have cash flow in your hands, which means I have a GST liability, I do not have the money to pay it. So I'm filing the nil returns this month and next month I'll file the returns when I have the money. Your interest will always be calculated from the time of supply concept and not based on your return filing. So you will always be liable for the interest, and where you are not filing returns, then there you can have a show cause notice and e-way bill blocking. Another important, this is not an error, but this is basically a value addition. Many assessees who are supplying to e-commerce or government authorities will probably have TDS and TCS cash balances which can be claimed. So if you go to the cash ledger and you put the TDS and TCS received, on a monthly basis you can verify what has been filed by the e-commerce or the governmental authorities. And such deductions which have been made can be accepted, filed with your EVC or DSC, and you can use such cash balances to pay your output tax, which will be very much useful in times of in the present times where you have huge cash flow problems. Next is the cash payment in wrong tax heads. Earlier there was a provision which was enabled through the PMT 09. Which it was provided for in the rules, but it was not notified. Presently also it is not yet notified, but the portal has now enabled PMT 09. Please note, you can only transfer between major heads and from a minor head to a major head, but you cannot transfer from a major head to a minor head. What I mean to say is, you cannot transfer from the tax ledgers, that is CGST, SGST and IGST, to interest, penalty and fees ledgers. So this is what is the implication. Now, any persons who have made incorrect tax payments into wrong heads, earlier were going for refunds and had to go and give a fiscal form and follow up with the department. Now that issue is rectified through this PMT 09. Next is, the negative values cannot be shown in GSTR 3B of Table 3. So imagine you have a liability of IGST, but in the next month the credit transaction was cancelled and you have raised a credit note. So you have a negative IGST value for the next period, but this was only a one-off transactions, and generally all your transactions are CGST and SGST. So how will I show a negative IGST transaction, IGST value in GSTR 3B? Presently, this is not allowed. If you do not have any other IGST liability arising, then your only option is to go for a refund. But in the new returns, it will allow you to consider a negative value in the returns and will be adjusted in the subsequent returns when the liability arises. So presently, the requirement is that you have to track all these negative values offline because it cannot be displayed in the GSTR 3B. Next is the concept of single credit note against multiple invoices and the ICE gate linking. Now, all these have already been told that this will be done by the department, but the portal has not enabled such features. This will be very useful for the assessees but inability from the technical aspect is leading to issues for the assessees. Now, amendments to the B2B values, which are being allowed even after the month of September month returns. Now, this is in contravention to the GST Act. So, Section 39 of the CGST Act says that for the financial year up to the September of the subsequent financial year, changes can be made, after which changes for that financial year will not be allowed. But the portal is allowing such changes. Please don't be utilizing such portal issues in your favor, because you will still be in contravention of the law. Now, these are the errors with resolutions. There are some issues which do not have a resolution even till date. Refund vouchers cannot be disclosed in GSTR 1. In the starting, I think for maybe 6 months or 10 months, the refund voucher was option was available. Then it was removed in the GSTR 1, but the rules have not been amended. B2C amendments, you cannot understand for which month the amendment has been made. Only the place of supply and the value will be reflected. Now, in relation to interest, when you are paying, you cannot pay only CGST or SGST. You will have to pay for both, because it is auto populating the other when one of the details is included. Now, portal, which is allowing either to accept or reject invoices, but it's not allowing to keep pending and defer for succeeding months. I have made a small error here. This is in relation to your TDS and TCS that has to be included. So you can only accept or reject the invoices, but you're not allowed to keep it pending and claim it in the subsequent months. So those are all the common errors that we have gone through, and most of which are given with possible resolutions. I have also given a simple reconciliation between 2A to GSTR 3B. This can be seen at your leisure separately. It is very detailed and it can be utilized for your day-to-day activities. I will GSTR 4 details has been provided, although I am short of time, so I will move on to the payment of tax, and then I'll go into the checklists. So, as you know, all the payments in relation to CGST as late fees, penalty, interest can be done on the GST portal. But there are various methods of making this payment. You can make it through your credit card or debit card, which is by authorized bank, internet banking, NEFT and RTGS from any bank. And also over the counter, if you are making any payment, which is only up to 10,000 rupees for such tax period. Now, there has always been some difficulty in understanding the utilization of input tax credit for the payment of tax. So Rule 88A, which is applicable from 1st April 2019, I give a simple understanding. Consider you have an IGST output and you have IGST credit. First, you'll have to utilize the credit of IGST against the output of IGST. Once the IGST output is extinguished, that means the output is nil, but you still have some IGST credit which is remaining, then you can use it for either CGST or SGST in any manner and in any order. So this is very important. It can be used in any manner or in any order. The GST portal will auto-populate to utilize it for CGST entirely. But you can edit such details and utilize it in any manner or any order. But most importantly, it can be utilized only after the IGST output is completely extinguished. Next is the CGST credit. You can utilize the credit only if IGST credit is fully utilized. And then first you utilize it against the CGST output and then against IGST. Similarly for SGST, and as you all know, the CGST credit cannot be utilized against SGST output and vice versa. So hope all of you have understood the utilization of input tax credit. This is very important for tax optimization upon payment of taxes. So these are all the various forms which are there. I would not like to get into it. There are some additional information which is important. Your payment challan is valid only for 15 days. So once you raise a payment challan, but you have not completed the activity of making the payment, you can do so and it is valid for 15 days. Once you have made the payment, a CIN number will be generated. And interest, as you all know, will be applicable at 18%. I have also given the path for PMT09 below. That is, you go into login to the portal, dashboard, services, ledger, electronic cash ledger, and file GST PMT09. So now we will get into the use of checklist. Now, a checklist is a basic information gather place where you gather a lot of information before you file your returns. So you have the checkpoints as to what has to be done in order to then file the returns. So this has been categorized into broad categories. That is registration, supply, place of supply, time of supply, value. So all these details, there are separate questions that you need to answer for each of the points. So I'll quickly run you through a sample. So I have provided a sample of the outward supply checklist. For each of these headings, there's another set of 10 to 15 questions. We generally have a checklist of around 100 to 150 points for the assistance, and for reviews we have around 600 points checklist. So I'll just show you for outward supply. So first thing that the preparer of the GST return needs to check is what and all are the types of supplies which are there in that month. So it can be your local domestic supplies, export, deemed export, exempted, non-GST, job work, stock transfers. It could be even sample and free gifts, or also could be the scrap sales. And if you notice, all the in relation to this, all the section references have been provided so that you can go there and then verify whether that has any impact on the valuation or any other ancillary aspects. Next is, now whenever I'm speaking about the checklist, it is in relation to the person preparing the returns. So please think from that point of view. So if I am preparing, I need to obtain the list of major products and services that the entity is supplying with the classification and the HSN. If there are any exempted, please ensure that the credit related to that inputs cannot be availed. So this is a checkpoint which is there. We would also check whether the entities have properly declared the goods and services as per Schedule 2. So Schedule 2 provides what are the supplies and whether they are goods or whether they are services under GST. And that is something we need to verify. So verify if any transactions fall under Schedule 3. This is very important. Also in February 2019, there was an amendment to include few other elements into Schedule 3 and also amend the ITC reversal under Section 17(3). So check whether any goods or services or both are supplied without consideration. This comes under Schedule 1. So this is a very important clause, because automatically when someone thinks that there is no consideration to a transaction, they think it's not a supply, but it still could be a supply. For example, point A, permanent transfer of any business assets where the ITC has been claimed. So there it will still be a liability even if it is supplied without consideration. Transactions between the related parties or distinct persons as defined in Section 25. Supplies to employees other than gifts of value of 50,000 in a financial year. And supplies between principal and agent. So all these are supplies which can take place without consideration, and then the valuation has to be considered separately and the transaction has to be offered to tax. Check whether any amount is recovered from the employees. If yes, analyze the applicability of GST on the same. Now here there's a tip: notice period recoveries, GST is not liable. There are many cases which are available to prove that the liability is non-existent, although there may be some other recoveries from the employees which could be liable, for example transport or canteen. Next point is in relation to composite supply. So here the requirement is you need to classify a transaction whether it is a composite supply or it is a mixed supply. This will have an impact on the tax rate that has to be charged and can have a significant impact. But for it to be a composite supply, it should be naturally bundled and supplied together. Tax rate would be as applicable to the principal supply. Single nomenclature should be used in the invoice, and ensure that such classification is also done in your books of accounts. So this is something which is very important, which has to be considered, because it can have a significant tax impact at a later point in time. If it is a mixed supply, ensure that the highest rate has been made applicable, and also a single price is to be charged for the supply. The next checkpoint is whether the client is making any continuous supply of goods or services. Here the time of supply and the raising of invoices have a different requirement than for the normal supply of goods and services. That's why you need to understand whether there are any continuous supply of goods or services. So with this, we have come to the end of the use of checklist. I hope you have understood the detail in which a checklist can be created, and it has to be created for all these points to ensure that you are completely verifying all the related transactions and not missing out on any checkpoints for filing a correct and valid GST return. So with this, I come to the end of my session, and I can take up some questions from the chat box.
Yeah, Akshay. I will read out the questions for your easy reference. Before that, I just want to inform the participants that there are some changes in the PPT used by the speaker during the session. So we have updated such PPT in the link. The updated link is there in chat box. You can download the updated PPT from there. And also the link which we have shared in the morning at 8:30 has also been updated. You can re-download it, the updated version of the PPT. Yeah. Moving on to the question.
Yes, Sarjan.
The first query, raised by Mr. Mohit Israni. Sir, currently 15 days time has been given for payment of tax for the purpose of filing GST R3B without any interest. Considering the extension of the lockdown, will such extension 15 days has been extended or not?
Sir, even we were expecting such extension to take place, but considering that the government is short of funds presently, there may not be an extension for the interest clause. Please note the due date has not changed, only the relaxation of interest has been provided. This may not be possible, although it is impossible for a person to file his GST 3B returns for the period when the offices are closed. So till date we have not received any notifications. But considering the government's position also, this may not look feasible. So suggest you to be ready to file the GST R3B by 5th.
Okay. The next query by Mr. Abhay Sood. The query is in relation to Rule 36.4. I am filing my monthly returns, whereas my supplier is filing return on quarterly basis. He is filing his GST on quarterly basis. Due to this, there is always being a reconciliation between my 2A versus books input tax credit. What is your suggestion and how to face it?
So the rule 36.4 has no reference to quarterly filers. Also, the clarifications given by the department does not have any information on what is to be done for quarterly filing cases. So the suggestion that can be given is, if you know that your quarterly vendor is filing on a regular basis and you know that he is paying the taxes correctly, you take the credit on a monthly basis as in when you receive the invoices and satisfy the eligibility conditions. If you are unable to ensure that he is filing the returns, suggest you to take the credit only once it is reflecting in your GSTR 2A. That means you will have to claim the credit on a quarterly basis also. So there are two options, but both it's dependent upon the vendor's compliance status.
Okay. So can we claim the credit just once he upload in his GSTR1? That means when the status is showing that non-submitted, is it suggestible to take the credit based on that status, or we need to wait till he is filing his return?
As far as I remember, the rule says that whatever is reflecting in your GSTR1. So whether it is filed, whatever is reflecting in GSTR 2A, sorry. So whether it is filed or not filed, he's already disclosed such details. But to be on the safer side, suggest you to consider only those which have been submitted and not just uploaded.
Okay. Hope the query has been answered properly. And the next query, I have only credit note during the period. Since GSTR 3B does not accept the negative figure, what is the procedure to disclose such credit notes?
Yeah, so like I said, it is part of my common errors in resolution slide. If you do not have a subsequent liability against such tax head, and you have only a negative liability, then the only other option is to go for a refund.
Okay, so I have time limit till September month return. Even if till September month return I couldn't adjust, then I can go for a refund. That is what you are saying, right?
Yes, exactly.
Yeah. Yes, Akshay. Moving to next question, query raised by Mr. Shankar. I have claimed the input tax credit based on GSTR 2A. Credit which is reflecting in GSTR 2A. However, subsequently, in the subsequent month, my supplier has reversed or amended the transaction. So how to deal with that? Whether my interest liability applies retrospectively or prospectively from the date of amendment?
Okay, so here the situation is that he has incorrectly reversed, as I understand, because if it is a invoice which was correctly raised and a credit note was raised appropriately under the law, then the credit would not be eligible even to the recipient. But in a case where he has reversed that invoice, but the credit is eligible and the transaction was valid without a credit note requirement, then in such cases you have to ensure that he files the a fresh invoice against that invoice to ensure that there is no dispute on such credit.
Okay. The next query by Mr. Mohit Israni. Sir, there is a time limit for availment of input tax credit as per section 16.4. What okay. happens to my credit relating to TDS and TCS deducted by my suppliers and recipient customers? Well, is there any time limit to avail the credit of TCS and TDS?
No, as far as I understand, this is a deduction. It is a cash balance which is reflecting. It's similar to your TDS under income tax law. You can claim the TDS that has been deducted by your customers. So in this case also, this TDS and TCS will add to your cash balance. And I do not see any time limit which has been mentioned in the law. So Arjun, have you seen any time limit?
Yeah, there is no time limit for the availment of this TDS and TCS because it is being, as you rightly said, it is being accumulated in your cash ledger. Time limit is only in relation to availment of credit. Even for credit, once it has been credited to your credit ledger, there is no time limit. You can utilize whenever you want. And moreover, this TDS and TCS amount will be reflecting in your cash ledger. So even for 17-18 TCS credit, which you have, you can accept that credit, which will be transferred to your cash ledger, and you can utilize the same even today.
Sure. We'll go to the next question.
Yeah, next question, Akshay. Query raised by Mr. Vignesh. I have shown the transaction in GSTR 1 instead of B2B, I have shown it as B2C. How to correct or amend such transaction in the subsequent month when there is no B2C available in next month?
Okay, so the correct thing to do here is to file a B2C amendment for that previous month, and this will revise the values of the previous month. And you do not need any B2C liability in the next month for this amendment. And once you do this amendment, it will be a downward amendment, and the B2B invoice can be updated in the B2B sheet. With this, it will reflect in the GSTR 2A of your customer, and credit would be eligible.
Okay.
Arjun, one thing I would like to add here is that what the cases where the amendment is allowed only once in for a month. So here what happens is, if it is already amended and there is another amendment which has to be taken place, because of the restriction available in the law, I cannot make the amendment. Correct. Now what I am suggesting may not be 100% as per the law, but it will ensure the credit is available to the recipient. So how you do that is, instead of doing an amendment, you reduce the next month's liability. So always understand that the first requirement under law is amendment and not reducing the liability in B2C.
Okay.
If you are unable to do the amendment, then you can go for reduction in the B2C of the next month.
Yeah. Okay, Akshay. Yeah. Next query. We're moving to next query. Question raised by Mr. Gaurav Choraria. Sir, the client is reporting his advances liability in GSTR 1 regularly. However, he is not making the adjustment of advances in GSTR 1. However, he is doing such adjustments in GSTR 3B and books properly. Is this how to rectify the issue or these differences? And also, whether I need to include such advances in my HSN summary?
Point on including of HSN for advances for HSN summary, I opine that it is to be included, although there are other reviews that need not be included in the HSN summary. This is an ambiguous situation, but if you do include, ensure that when you are including, you will always have a plus and minus in the month when you raise an actual invoice. So in that month, when you raise the invoice, it should not be included again for the purpose of HSN. Alternatively, what you also can do is not include when advance is put. You can include when the tax invoice is raised. That is in relation to HSN. In relation to incorrect disclosures, what you have mentioned is the disclosure has been incorrectly done only in GSTR 1, but the advance adjustment has been correctly disclosed in the GSTR 3B and books. If this is the case, if you are unable to show it in the subsequent GSTR 1, it does not have any tax impact. You can ignore such issue and show correctly in your GSTR annual returns. But going forward, better to ensure appropriate disclosures, because you always run the risk of the general penalty rule of 50,000.
Yeah. Okay. The next question by Mr. C.A. Jatan Jain. It is in continuation to his previous query, where he has asked that when there is a negative figure which is going to be reflected in 3B, as the 3B is not allowing me to disclose the negative figure, we told him to defer the disclosure in subsequent returns till the return for the month of September following the financial year. And we have also suggested him that if it is not possible to adjust in subsequent returns, go for refund. He is asking, based on which provisions of the law we are suggesting him to go for refund?
This will be covered under section 54 itself. where it says that if you have made any payment against a tax and you have which is how not can provided. I say
service not provided, supply not happened,
where the service or supply is not provided, then you can go for the refund of the same. If I'm not wrong, it is 54(8)(e).
Yeah, correct.
Section 54(8)(e). So based on that, you can go for a refund.
And also that circular 26/2017 also instructed the assessees to do the same, na?
Yes.
Yeah. Thank you, Akshay. The next query by Mr. Anirudh Tiwari. Sir, once the TDS TCS credit has been taken, it will be transferred to my tax ledger. Can I use that cash portion for the payment of interest or late fee using PMT09, which has been recently amended?
Sir, so what I had explained earlier in relation to PMT09 was, you cannot make the transfer from a major head to a minor head. That means you cannot transfer from CGST, SGST, IGST heads, tax heads, to interest, penalty or fees. So with this, your question stands invalid. You cannot do that. You will have to pay such amounts separately through cash, through the to the cash ledger, and then discharge the appropriate liability.
Okay. The next query by Mr. Dushyant Taneja. As you have already answered that query, but still he has re-raised. As you said, sir, we can amend only once for a period as per in GSTR1 based on the portal. What if I have already amended once and subsequently I require one more amendment for the period? What is the solution to such amendments, re-amendments?
The only solution, and I am telling this not under the law which is allowed, is to pass a full value credit note and raise a fresh invoice. That is the only way that I see it. But whether you satisfy the conditions of raising a credit note and a fresh invoice, it may not satisfy these conditions under the law. So you are running a risk of this doing it in this way. But this will ensure that you can collect the money from your customers and they can also take the credit.
Yeah. Okay, Akshay. The next query by Mr. Janarthanan ji. For the availment of entitlement of credit under section 16 subsection 2, there is one condition D saying that he needs to furnish a return under section 39. The he refers whom, whether the supplier or the person who is claiming the credit.
Here the requirement is that it is the recipient who has filed the return. I'm sorry, it is the supplier who has filed the return.
What he was asking is not for the third condition. The third condition says the supplier has to pay the tax to the government. He's asking for the next condition, where it is saying that he has furnished the return under section 39. So here, he is asking for the next condition. So what you have said in the first
recipient.
It covers the recipient. The next query by Mr. Venkata Subramaniam. Sir, I have received the advance in service tax regime and raised the invoice in GST regime. What is the procedure provided in the law for such adjustments?
So here, this is covered under the transitional provisions. So it is covered under section 142(11). So in that you have 142(11)(ABC). So please refer those provisions under which you are covered under, and then you can verify. As far as I understand, if it is purely service tax, you have to pay the GST only on the balance portion which is liable to tax. So if you have received advance for a transaction of 10 lakhs and you have received an advance of only 5 lakhs, then you need to pay GST only on the balance portion of 5 lakhs. But where you come up into a situation where there is VAT and service tax liability, there the transitional provisions is different. You need to take the credit of whatever tax was paid on advances and discharge GST on the entire transaction value based on your time of supply. Yeah. So this would generally be the two examples which I can think of is construction industry and for pure services, maybe restaurant accommodation services.
Okay. Okay, Akshay. Moving on to next query by Mr. C.A. Srinivas. Sir, I have disclosed all my credit note pertaining to financial year 17-18 in my monthly GSTR 1. However, I have not disclosed in 3B. That means I have not reduced my output tax liability. Can I disclose such credit note in my annual return and claim refund?
Sir, if the credit note is valid and you had disclosed it correctly in GSTR 1, you can disclose it under in the GSTR 9, but the refund will not be enabled through the GSTR 9. You will have to apply for a separate refund and take the credit, take the refund.
Okay. The next query, yeah, I hope it is answered. The next query is raised by Mr. Ayush Gupta. Sir, is there any option to show procurements from unregistered person in GSTR 3B?
Procurements from
unregistered person?
Presently, no. I do not think there is only an option to show non-taxable exempt inward supplies. So other than that, I do not see an option for unregistered inward supplies.
Okay.
But please not for the purpose of reverse charge from unregistered parties, which is now presently applicable for the real estate sector. This is something which has to be tracked offline.
Okay. The next query by Mr. Shankar. Sir, I have not disclosed HSN summary in my GSTR 1 return till date. What is the consequence of non-disclosure? How I can rectify that?
Sir, HSN summary, there is no amendment tables available presently. So if you have not disclosed, suggest you to disclose in the subsequent return itself. And also give information to the department that because I did not disclose in the previous month, it is being disclosed in the subsequent month. That is the only way that I see.
Yeah. The next query by Mr. Kenil Darod. Sir, presently there has been a relaxation and relief provided for filing of GSTR 3B in purview of COVID-19. What if I have not filed the return within the time limit which they have provided, that means 30th June, averagely, I have filed subsequently, I have filed the returns for pertaining to April, May in the month of July or August. So how to calculate interest? Can I eligible to claim such concessional interest rate for that intervening period, or I need to calculate the entire interest at 18% for the entire period?
Entire period 18% is the answer. This has also been clarified through the circular which was made available also.
Okay. The next query.
Arjun, we'll take last two queries. It's already
11:10. Yeah. Last two. Yeah.
Balance, you can send it to me and we'll respond to the persons in through email.
Okay. So the two last queries for the session before we wind up. Query raised by Mr. Mohit Israni. Sir, in case of ISD, Input Service Distributor, how can we disclose the tax distributed by one branch to another in GSTR 6?
Tax distributed from one branch to another.
Yeah.
I do not know the specific table reference. You can park this question. I'll see the actual form and then I can respond to.
Then I can.
Yeah. Okay. So I respond, I have to see the form to give the correct answer.
Okay. The next query, the last query for the session which were to be answered online. Balance query, I will mail it to you for your replies. Can you explain?
Including
this ISD provisions, I will mail you.
Yes.
The last question for the session, sir, can you explain briefly once more relating the transferability of taxes through PMT09? How we can make utilize of this PMT09?
So PMT09 is available for transfer within the major heads. That is, if you have within IGST, CGST or SGST cash balance, you can transfer to any of the other tax heads, that is CGST, SGST, IGST. You can transfer to any of them. That is first. Second one is, you can transfer if you have cash balance in penalty, interest or late fees. You can transfer from those heads to the tax heads, that is CGST, SGST or IGST.
Okay.
So this is what is allowed. What is not allowed is, you cannot transfer from the tax heads, that is CGST, SGST, IGST, to the minor heads, that is penalty, interest and fees.
Okay.
I hope
it has been answered. Hope the participant got clarified through the explanation. So whatever queries being unanswered till now will be shared with you through mail, and you will be receiving the answer from the speaker through mail reply. By this end, I thank Akshay for spending your valuable time to provide value addition to our participants in relation to GST returns and giving them solutions for and clarifications for their queries. Thank you, Akshay. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Arjun, and thank you all the attendees for your attention and for your time. If you have any other doubts, you can always reach me at my email ID, which is given in the last slide. Thank you. And I also would like to thank Hiriganga Academy. Arjun, please thank share you. The questions offline.
Yeah. I will share you. And one more clarification which I require to give to participants. If you are not able to access the link given in the chat box, you can always go back to the reminder mail which has been shared with you today morning 8:30, where the links are provided. We have updated the PPT in those links also. By clicking that link, you can get the updated PPT. Kindly make use of that. Thank you. Now we will go for a short break. We will resume by 11:40. Rajendra.
No, it says would resume by 11:40 a.m. That is the one. Okay. Okay. One second. Say 1:47.
Dear participants, we are now going for the next session. This will be taken up by BSV Murthy sir. The topic is genesis of disputes and prevention and its mitigation. Murthy sir, for all of you. Mr. BSV, excuse me. Mr. BSV Murthy sir is having experience of 42 years in indirect tax laws. He has served at the following positions in various departments of Government of India. I'll just name the wherever he has rendered service. It's very interesting to know. He started his career in March 1981 to November 1987. He was Assistant Commissioner Customs and Central Excise, and he worked from 87 to 1991 as Undersecretary. Deputy Secretary, Department of Education. From November 1994 to July 1998, he was Joint Commissioner. From August 1998 to May 2001, he was Additional Commissioner, Customs and Central Excise. From June 2001 to October 2002, he was Additional Commissioner, Customs House. From November 2002 to October 2004, he was Commissioner, Customs House. From October 2004 to April 2006, he was Additional Director General, Director of Revenue Intelligence, MOF. From May 2006 to March 2008, he worked as Commissioner of Central Excise and Service Tax. And then from March 2008 to July 2015, he was a member of Customs, Excise and Service Tax Appellate Tribunal. Is a member of SESTAT. So we have a very resourceful person. I think you can make use of this opportunity to gain knowledge. And over to you, Murthy sir, you can start the session.
Thank you. Good morning to all the participants. Today's subject is somewhat new, and normally this type of subject is not included in the certificate course. We are going to talk about disputes, how they arise, what are the sources of disputes, how to avoid them, and how to mitigate them. Because disputes with the department have become a real problem in both the tax departments, whether it is direct or indirect in India. You keep reading in the newspapers that large amounts of revenue is stuck up in litigation. In fact, quite often we read that there is a lot of amount held up because of litigation. But if you see the record of the tax departments, if you see the appeals before the tribunal and courts, in almost 80% of the appeals filed by the department, department loses. In 80% of the appeals filed by the assessees win. This is exactly opposite to each other. This shows that the department basically is prone to litigate and prone to prolong the disputes. Therefore, what happens is we have to know how the disputes arise, how exactly we are going to, what are the types of disputes, and how we can prevent them, and if we can't prevent them, how to face them. Basically, we try to cover these aspects today. In fact, the coverage of the topic will be as follows. First is introduction, which I have already completed. The next one will be types of source of disputes. Next one I will be taking up reasons for disputes, areas of disputes, how the disputes commence, and how we can prevent disputes. In fact, when we come to prevention of disputes, there are two parts. One is the legal provisions. The law itself also has provisions with an intention to prevent disputes. And what are the strategies the taxpayers can adopt to prevent the disputes? Also, we will discuss briefly. The finally, mitigation, how exactly we will settle the dispute, what are the methods that you can have. Under these headings, I will be covering the subject. And within the subject, for example, types of sources of disputes, there will be separate headings. Each type I will briefly explain. Types of sources of disputes, headings for discussion. One is nature of tax. The next is multiplicity of rates, multiple exemptions, assessment, audit, modus operandi circulars, anti-evasion machinery, advocates and consultants, tax prevention efforts of taxpayers, retrospective amendments, and others. These are the various types which create disputes in the department. So under these headings, we will take up one by one. Now, first is the nature of tax. The taxation can be proportional, progressive, and regressive. A tax is called proportional if all the people, taxpayers, pay the tax in proportion of their income as tax. It is progressive. It is proportional. It is progressive when the income, when the tax varies with income levels. So our income tax system is the example for it. The final one is regressive tax. Indirect taxes are generally regressive because they are same for all and the burden would be more on the poor. These are the things. So when the tax is regressive, which GST is, if the rates are also high, then what happens? The natural tendency for the taxpayers is to try to avoid the tax or evade the tax by whatever method they can think of, depending upon their approach to the taxation. People who are law-abiding would like to find out legal loopholes. The people who want to avoid by hook or crook will try to evade. Then further, in addition to this regressive nature of the tax and also the higher rate of tax, further difficulties come when the law is complicated. And if you must have already understood, because a lot of subjects have already been covered during the past few days, and you would have already understood how complicated is our law. In fact, it has been complicated earlier, and unfortunately, even now, it continues to be complicated. And when the law is complicated, again, the sources of disputes also increase. The next one is multiplicity of rates. Ideally, GST should be one rate or two rates, or maximum three rates. By and large, that is the intention. However, in our country, we have seven rates, 0, 0.5, 3, 5, 12, 18, and 28. In addition, there is a composition system, and composite dealers and others have a separate rate. There is zero rating for exports. So because of this multiplicity of rates, the efforts will be of the taxpayer to see how he can pay the tax at a lower rate. So this is again another source of dispute. When the rates are more, the tendency is to look for a lower rate. Then we have multiple exemptions. When there are multiple exemptions, again, we will like to look which exemption I can avail, how to avail the exemption. And unfortunately, in India, we not only think that GST law should collect taxes and bring revenue to government, but we also want to achieve several socio-economic objectives. Because of this intention to achieve socio-economic objectives, help the poor, tax the rich, identify sin commodities, so on and so forth, the result would be a plethora of exemptions, plethora of rates, which are basically against the basic principles of GST, and again another source of dispute. The next one is assessment. We started the indirect tax in India where an officer used to be present in the manufacturer's premises. He used to assess the tax the tax had to be paid, then the goods used to go out. Then we moved to self-removal procedure, where the manufacturer would manufacture the goods, remove the goods himself, but he will file returns which are assessed. This, when the assessment was done by the department, there was a time limit for issuing the demand, because one is you used to get the returns assessed by the department and people used to come to know. Now we have entered the regime of self-assessment. It is totally self-assessment. In fact, it is a misnomer to call it, to say that the department is collecting the taxes. The reality is the taxpayers assess the tax, pay it, and thereafter the department will come and say whether you have paid the tax correctly or not. Now, what has happened is, in GST law, even a bona fide mistake in self-assessment of tax payable, supposing the department finds that there is a mistake and they will write to you and you don't agree, you feel what you have done is right, thereafter they will issue a show cause notice, you feel okay, issue me an order. Once, if the order has to be issued, there is a penalty of 10,000 rupees or 10% of the tax, whichever is higher. That means when the department wrote to you, you should have paid, you did not pay it. When show cause notice was issued, you should have paid, you did not pay it. Now you are disputing the tax, you are disputing the stand taken by the department. Therefore, in the adjudication order, it is mandatory for the office adjudicating authority to impose penalty. And finally, this penalty for contesting the liability and to get it back finally and win the case, you may have to go even up to Supreme Court. This is a situation. So this is assessment is a source of dispute, because you make a bona fide mistake or a deliberate mistake, you can get into a dispute with the department. Delay in payment of a self-assessed tax can lead to 10% of tax or 10,000 penalty. Seek provisional assessment, and finalization can be a source of dispute. You have to pay interest on the liability at 8%, but you will get refund at 6%. Officers have the power to reassess, assess on the basis of best judgment, summary assessment, every type of activity by the officers in the form of reassessment, best judgment assessment, summary assessment can be a source of dispute. There is no time limit for issue of debit note. If the value goes up, or if you think that you have made a mistake, you have to pay, you should have paid a higher tax, you can issue a debit note. There is no limit, there is no time limit for it. And you have to pay the differential tax. But there is a time limit for issuing credit note to reduce tax liability, and there is a concept of unjust enrichment. So every one of this area, next one is you have made excess payment of tax, you can't get back. So these are another, the assessment itself is another area of dispute with so many possibilities of disputes. Officers can come, sit in your office, do the audit, do inspection, conduct search, every one of, and make, do audits. And after that, they will make audit observations. And they will give you oral assurances that you pay the tax, nothing will happen, and matter will end. Quite often you will think, all right, why litigation? Why dispute? And pay the tax. Subsequently, you will get it. Show cause notice for 100% penalty and tax, fine, etc., etc. Sometimes the taxpayer may get relief only when the matter reaches Supreme Court, by which time you have to deposit 30% of the tax payable, and only when you win, you will get back the amount with 9% simple interest. Therefore, this is another source of dispute. When the officers come for audit, they will, their observations, their letters, their indications can be another source of dispute. The next one is modus operandi circulars. The department has a system of issuing modus operandi circulars. Quite often, when you are talking to a friend, that friend will say, oh, I did this and nothing happened. I was able to pay less tax. I paid only 5%, whereas you are paying more, or I have found a method to reduce the value. Something he will say, you think, okay, this is a good idea, and you will also follow. And department catches one fellow who has used this loophole in the law, or who has found this method to evade the tax. And within the department, they issue a modus operandi circular based on the audit observations or evasion cases detected. Once that is done, the officers, when they come to you, they know about these circulars. The moment they find that you have done, you have used that loophole, or you have found the, you have used that method to reduce the tax, promptly a dispute starts. Anti-evasion machinery. Again, officers have enormous powers in India for investigation, search, seizure, arrest, etc., which lead to commencement of disputes. In fact, the tax officers are powerful even all over the world. You may remember the famous case of the mafia leader was caught by IRS in US rather than by the police, because that is the kind of power revenue services enjoy all over the world. Here also, there is absolutely no shortage of power in the hands of officers. The investigation at every stage, there can be disputes. They can intercept the goods in transit, seize and confiscate the goods, and you may end up paying the tax twice just to get the goods and get into a long litigation process. Again, here also they have a system of exchange of modus operandi circulars for evasion of taxes, and it is very risky to think that this is a method of evasion which is unique and nobody can catch me. Advocates and consultants also can create problems. First thing is, if they don't know the law sufficiently, they can create problem. The second thing is, they think that they can help you evade the tax or avoid the tax. That also can create a problem. And even their mistakes can create problems. Therefore, while choosing the advocates and consultants also, you have to be careful, because a wrong person can create problems. I know of one case where an auditor advised the party that you pay the department said you should have paid the interest for the past 5 years, you have not paid. So he immediately said you should pay. In fact, legally, once you have filed the return properly, those days according to the law, interest was not automatically payable. But he advised you should pay. Fortunately, this person did not simply believe the chartered his consultant. He inquired again, and thereafter he was able to ensure that he paid only for 1 year, and the remaining 2-3 years he did not have to pay. Therefore, advocates and consultants also can be a source of disputes, and then sources. It is not that taxpayers don't contribute in source of disputes. Tax prevention of efforts of taxpayers is another source of dispute. Payment of tax is a pain for everyone, especially in India. We don't want to maintain accounts properly. We don't want to pay the taxes. But the problem is, efforts to reduce the tax liability without adequate knowledge of law and the consequences can result in a situation where even the business itself may end up as a total failure. In fact, the best thing to do is to gain as much knowledge of the law as possible and try to be fully honest, totally honest, and full compliance with the legal provisions. This is the best option. What happens when you do this? you will have complete peace of mind. And normally such taxpayers also command respect from the department. They treat you well, and more often than not reduces disputes. Once the department comes to know that you want to follow the law and you will not try to evade the tax, and you will always try to cooperate and ensure that you follow the law strictly. Now in the GST law, they have a compliance rating system which is going to be introduced. With the result, with the compliance rating system, periodic audits and your own level of knowledge of law and compliance is going to improve your reputation with the department along in the trade, and automatically disputes will come down. Another problem is retrospective amendments. Quite often the government amends the law retrospectively. In fact, this is not happening today. It has happened for the past for 30, 40 years. In fact, earlier there was a rule in excise law that within the factory, if the goods are removed, you have to pay the tax. Somebody went to Supreme Court and they won the case. They amended the law to say that from 1944, this law exists. Even now, in the GST law, they have made a provision that within 1 year, they can add explanations to the notifications, and these explanations will have the retrospective effect from the date of notification. Only thing is, this has to be done within 1 year. In any case, the government keeps amending the law retrospectively, and the parliament has the power to do that. And sometimes these retrospective amendments can create retrospective liabilities also. Therefore, taxpayers have to keep track of the amendments, and sometimes even beneficial amendments will be lost. So just to give one example of this retrospective amendments, last time the rule 96 was amended with retrospective effect. As a result, many of the exporters had to face a lot of difficulties, and they continue to face the difficulties. Now, there is another category which is always there, that is others. It is not that the government does not contribute. The finance ministry, that is Central Board of Indirect Taxes and Customs, also issues clarifications, sometimes which are confusing and sometimes controversial and sometimes patently wrong. In fact, the Supreme Court had to say in one case that it is not that the circular issued by the board is binding on everybody. It is definitely not binding on taxpayers, but it is binding on the officers. And even officers need not follow it if it is against the law. Then we have conflicting advance rulings. Now, in the GST era, because the advance rulings are given by the level of officers of the rank of additional commissioners, the quality has suffered, and there are diverse rulings with different views being taken in different states. In fact, earlier in the indirect tax regime of Central Excise and Customs or in income tax, the advance ruling authority used to be chaired by a Supreme Court judge, and the members of the advance ruling authority used to be members of the board of very senior level. In the GST era, because of advance rulings has come down to a lower level, we find that quality has suffered, and also we are getting conflicting decisions by different advance ruling authorities. And again, this will create further problems because you may have to go to court. Of course, advance ruling, there is another problem is advance ruling is binding on the person who has gone for the advance ruling. Then conflicting judicial pronouncements, the tribunals and high courts keep giving their own interpretations. Then articles in websites and newspapers, self-acclaimed experts and advised by departmental officers. These are all sources of disputes. Then we come to the next issue. Why tax disputes arise? So this we will discuss in two categories. The tax disputes arise because of department, number one, because of taxpayers, number two. Now, when it comes to department, we have several headings. I have given the headings here, but I will go straight to the discussion. First one is aggressive tax collection behavior. Many times people think that why the department is behaving like this? They are getting rewards, they get promotions. In fact, there is nothing like that. But this is a mindset probably which has come from the British colonial era, that this aggressive tax collection behavior. In fact, India has a history of aggressive tax collection even in the times immemorial. Therefore, what happens is the tax collector is always having a revenue bias. Now we have the administrative law, which gives the powers of adjudication for the dispute within the to the departmental officers. Now, the one complaint we hear from everybody is that we hardly get favorable orders from the officers. They are supposed to pass orders which are not biased, which are fair. But general complaint is it doesn't happen. There is a revenue bias. And then as far as possible, the departmental officers will try to tell you that you pay the tax, and if possible interest, they pay the tax, interest, and nominal penalty within without contest. This is how the approach comes. And quite often it may be advisable also to pay this amount if you don't have a case. But by and large, even if the departmental officers are wrong, they will never say we are wrong. They will try to persuade you to pay the tax. So this is aggressive tax collection behavior. And what happens is many times the taxpayers also pay the amounts because you are afraid of creation of procedural difficulties by the department. Now, if you see, for the past 70 years, the effort of the government has been to try to reduce the interaction between the department and the taxpayers. Gradually, this is coming down, but the indirect tax law continues to be a procedural law, and a lot of procedures are required to be followed in terms of maintenance of records, in terms of issue of documents, in terms of making applications, etc., etc. As a result, there is always a fear of some procedural problem that may be created by the departmental officers. And another thing is, the departmental officers, even though you are supposed to follow the law, quite often the departmental officers themselves will try to persuade you and try to ignore the legal procedures which they have to follow. For example, adjustment of refund, which cannot be done unless the demand has attained a situation where it can be recovered. This would have been covered by some other subject. Again, the powers to provisionally attach your bank account, property, etc. These are areas where many times wrong approach is followed by the officers because of aggressive tax collection behavior. Then we come to the next level. The one thing which we keep hearing, especially after the introduction of GST, is that the level of knowledge of the officers is not sufficient. This is the feeling people are getting. Many people feel that officers are not able to advise them properly when they go for advice. So this is because of inadequate training. And in government, there is no incentive or disincentive. If you don't know the law, if you don't make a mistake, hardly a person gets punished. And if you know the law well, if you do the job well, there's hardly any special recognition. And there is a comfort of job security and promotion. In India, we all believe that if you go to government, your job is secure. Till you attain the age of 60, you are safe and you will get periodic promotions and salary is assured. Because of this, these reasons, there is a level of knowledge, there is lack of effort to improve the required skills and the level of knowledge which is required to perform the job efficiently. The next one, which we generally complain, especially the public, is that there is lack of accountability in government. And quite often, public also feels that there is no use in complaining because all are together. We will come to this part at the mitigation when we are talking of mitigation, but this is the general feeling. So there is a lack of accountability and indiscipline among officers. This is because one is senior level, the officers do not give priority to enforce accountability of their subordinates. The next one is, this is very big problem when, especially when they are exercising the quasi-judicial functions. They are expected to follow judicial discipline. Judicial discipline means if there is a higher forum, for example, High Court or a tribunal, which has given a ruling in a particular portion of the law that is bound to be followed. This is called judicial discipline. Unfortunately, quite often the officers ignore this. In fact, there are officers who have said that I don't care for the High Court decision and High Court has passed strictures, and you know, High Court can take contempt proceedings also. But even then, they are not afraid, because quite often, even in contempt proceedings, the courts very rarely punish people, because if you go and explain, I made a mistake, I'm sorry, quite often they are liberal in their approach. So as a result, what has happened is the judicial discipline has taken a hit. And when it comes to tribunals, they don't have the power to enforce their authority. They don't have contempt powers. As a result, quite often the decisions of the tribunals or directions of the tribunals are ignored. Another thing is tax disputes arise because there is lack of supervision and guidance, and there is no something called standard operating procedure. In one of the cases, when I was commissioner, 14 officers were charged because the department felt that one refund claim had been sanctioned wrongly. From the level of a tax assistant to the level of assistant commissioner, everybody was held responsible. How can 14 officers be responsible for one refund sanction? This is the question. So what happens is, because of lack of standard operating procedure, because of lack of set principles and guidelines, one is the delays are possible because the officers can go on issuing letters. They can call for this information, that information, and delay the process so that they need not take decision. And there are no set principles. There is no transparency. And couple this with public impression that there is no use in complaining. Somehow let us manage. There is also a fear among the taxpayers that by complaining to supervisory officers, the junior officers will give trouble, and junior officers are the ones with whom I have to deal with because they are there for a longer period, whereas senior officers keep getting transferred and they will go away. This is another difficulty. So lack of supervision and guidance from the senior level is another source for tax disputes. The next one is, there is a fear of audit, vigilance machinery, and CBA. These are also reasons for increase in tax disputes, because we used to have C&AG audit of taxpayers in central excise, service tax, and customs. When they find a mistake, ultimately, if it is a serious mistake, it will go right up to the Parliamentary Public Accounts Committee. And when it goes to Public Accounts Committee, the explanations of the officers who is responsible will be called for. This generated fear of audit. Another one is, you take a decision, you pass an order in favor of the party. There is a fear that there is a system of review in the department, and the vigilance machinery may see the order, and if they feel that why this person has given a favorable decision, and they may start inquiry and proceedings. Therefore, it is better to play safe and pass a decision which is in favor of the revenue. General impression among the officers, which has created the problem for taxpayers, is that if I pass an order in favor of the revenue, nothing will happen to me, even if the order is wrong. And the opposite, if I take a favorable decision, even if I am right, the chances are I will be punished. This is another problem. And fear of CBI is another reason. You give a complaint to CBI, CBI may conduct a search of the officer's premises, house, office, everywhere. And you may figure in the TV also if you are arrested. So this is a kind of organizations which also create fear in the officers' minds. And to some extent, they have also contributed. To be fair to say, this fear is somewhat exaggerated. All said and done, if officers have taken the right decision, rarely they have got into trouble. But then, there may be 100 cases where there is no trouble, but there is one case where there is trouble. That is what gets highlighted. That is what will be seen, and that is what will be in the minds of the officers. Now we come to the taxpayers. We talked about the departmental officers. Why tax disputes arise? Because of departmental people. Now we come to the other side, taxpayers. First is the complicated law, which I already briefly discussed. It was complicated earlier. It is complex. It has complicated procedures, and the procedures have to be known because there are rules, circulars, which undergo changes very frequently, because for making changes in the rules and notifications, the government doesn't have to go to parliament. These are all delegated legislation, and notifications can be amended, rules can be amended. As a result, they undergo very frequent changes, and you have to keep in touch with each change. Otherwise, you may end up making mistakes. The legal language is difficult for even departmental officers to understand, and for the layman, it is worse. The net result of all this is that even a knowledgeable assessor may make mistakes in understanding the law, and the disputes can start. The complications also result in loopholes, which are exploited by unscrupulous taxpayers, and again, disputes start. Cumbersome procedures. Procedures are complicated and detailed. Quite often, lawmakers, in respect of many aspects, have taken these aspects into account. For example, issue of show cause notice and order, requirement of TDS, TCS, reverse charge mechanism, issue of debit credit notes, job work process, export through merchant exporters, issue related to import of services. These are all required procedures, and some of them are quite complicated. And you make a mistake in some area, a dispute may start, and you may end up getting a show cause notice or a dispute will start, then you will have to go to the next step, which we will be discussing later, how to avoid or how to mitigate it. One thing we have to remember, that the law does not recognize ignorance of law as a valid ground. The fact remains, not only taxpayers, sometimes even officers are ignorant of law. But then this is not a ground which can be pleaded anywhere. It is settled that ignorance of law cannot be an excuse. Of course, there are valid reasons for it. That is not the, this is not the time to discuss those. But the problem is, when the law is complicated, there are several compliance requirements, and it is very difficult for an ordinary taxpayer to remember all of them. For example, you make a mistake. You don't make the payment within 180 days to the supplier. It is a matter between you and your supplier. For example, supplier has not complained, but then the law requires you to report it and reverse the ITC taken, and you make a mistake there, you have a problem. Your supplier may not create a problem, but government can create a problem. It will be an offense. Same way, for example, reverse charge mechanism. You have bought something from an unregistered person, or you have imported something, you have to issue an invoice for a supply made to yourself. But then if you don't know, you can, this will be an offense. And another thing, employees are related persons. You make some supply free to them. If it is not part of salary or CTC, it is liable to tax. These are some areas which an ordinary taxpayer may remember, may not remember. There are many more. Of course, the intention is not to cover everything here. And by the time you would have already come to know, because several aspects of law have already been covered in this course. Then next is, of course, deliberate evasion. Here, evasion of tax is a very lucrative profession in India, because number one, you can be competitive. Number two, your profit goes up. Number three, you save on income tax. Number four, you avoid high rate of tax. So it is very profitable to do it. But the only problem will come when you are caught. And the law is such that if you are caught, it can be extremely difficult. Therefore, even though evasion is a profitable proposition, but if you get into trouble, the trouble can be very serious. So there is a risk, great risk involved in deliberate evasion, but then a lot of people do it, and we keep reading them in newspapers. The next one is competition by taxpayer. You are in a business, you find that four other taxpayers are paying 5% and you have been paying 12%, and you went for advance ruling and you lost the case and you are still paying 12%, it becomes difficult. So competition, this kind of cases where the treatment of a particular service or a supply becomes different in one part of the country compared to others, can create a serious problem, because you have to face competition from those taxpayers. Similarly, competing with a tax evader also will be difficult. So many people who find it is difficult to compete with tax evaders or tax avoiders, are because of difference in practices between different states, how to think that, okay, I will also do this, and disputes arise. So widespread corruption is another problem. And another thing is, as a society, we accept widespread corruption. We have respect for the money, and parallel economy has become a problem. All these things make tax evasion attractive. But if you don't know the consequences, or you would come to know the consequences only when the dispute arises. It becomes a problem. So it is better to know when you are doing something, what are the consequences. Therefore, knowledge of law is extremely important. Then we come to areas of dispute in the law. Here I am not discussing in detail because each of these topic would have been covered, but the every area, the number of areas where disputes can arise itself will show you how complicated the law is and how much knowledge one should acquire and how knowledge of law helps. Taxable event, classification, time of supply, place of supply, valuation, input tax credit, registration, assessment and payment of tax, recovery of tax, accounts and records, documentation, invoice, e-way bill, payment for supplies, job work, returns, audits, inspection, investigation, search and seizure, TDS, TCS, refunds, liabilities which arise because of transfer of business, amalgamation, agent and principal relationship, liquidation, directors liability, partners liability, guardians liability, court of wards, trustees, discontinuance of business, death, transitional provisions, anti-profiting measures. I don't think I have completed all the areas. There are so many areas where disputes can arise, and you know what, you will not know what hit you. Any of the areas can come. So unless we know every area, what kind of problems can come, and I hope when the other subjects are covered, you would have come to know it is extremely difficult to deal with the law. Now we come to the next step, commencement of dispute. How the dispute start? No doubt we saw what are the sources of dispute, areas of dispute, how commencement of dispute, how they start. First one is a more serious thing, that is
Sorry to interrupt you, sir. Murthy sir, is it audible? Murthy sir, I think participants will get back to you. There is some technical issue.
Hello,
sir, you are audible, sir. Better to switch the camera, sir, because I think the internet bandwidth is not supporting. Click on that. You can switch off your camera. Only this will be visible, the PPT presentation, and audio will be very clear.
How to switch off the camera is a problem.
Yeah, I know. I'll tell you, sir.
One second.
On the side of your control panel, you have one second, sir. Just one second. On the right.
Okay. Can I start again?
Yeah. Sure, sir. From your left, you can start.
Sorry, there was a disturbance. Sorry to everyone. I think there was some problem with the system. Hopefully, even though you can't see me, I am told you can hear me.
Yes, sir.
So we'll start from where we were. Actually, hello? I'll start.
Hello, yeah, audible.
Okay, fine. Okay. So next issue is commencement of dispute. I had already given the introduction. So we have seen the type of areas, etc. How the dispute start? As I already told you, one is the powerful weapons of the department officers have, that is inspection, search, seizure, any business premises can be inspected, any premises can be searched if they have a reason to believe that you have evaded the tax, and if the amount involved is more than 2.5 crores, they can arrest the person, they can seize the vehicle if there is a documentation problem, they can seize the goods if there is a documentation problem, and all these things are sources, are the areas where the disputes can start. And in these areas, there is very little you can do. The only thing you can do probably, or only thing you should do to avoid this, is to always be honest and be knowledgeable and follow the law strictly and don't evade the tax under any circumstances. This is one way of course, we will be coming to the mitigation part later, but this is a problem which, if it starts, its consequences are very serious, because officers have tremendous powers to issue summons. And one more thing is, if police investigate the case, if they record a statement from you, even if you admit the offense, it doesn't make much of a difference, because in the court the police has to prove it, and your statement will not be considered as evidence unless under specific circumstances under Evidence Act. Whereas a statement recorded by an officer of indirect tax is valid as an evidence. As a result, quite often, if you admit the offense to avoid difficulties at the initial stages, you are sure to face difficulties at the later stages. So therefore, evasion is not a good policy, and quite often it can lead to this inspection, search and seizures. The next one is how the commencement starts, dispute starts. Intimation. You are supposing, you think that, okay, I am following this procedure, I don't know whether it is correct or wrong, so you inform the department. Now this information itself can lead to a dispute, because if the department doesn't agree, they may tell you, we don't agree with you, and if you don't agree with them, then the dispute starts. So quite often your correspondence with the department also can start a dispute. Therefore, when you are corresponding with the department, you should think whether it will create a dispute, and whether it is worthwhile getting into a dispute because of the letter, or you have to know what are the consequences of writing the letter, because sometimes writing the letter is helpful, especially because when the offense cases are registered, these intimations can help. If you have intimated the department that I am following this, and you have sought their advice, then extended period cannot be invoked, and what you have done will not be considered an offense. There is an advantage in intimation, but at the same time, it can create a dispute. But if you are legally correct and if the department agrees with you, intimation is helpful. And if the department agrees with you, and later on also, the demand also will be limited to a normal period, not the extended period. Of course, audits I already mentioned. Then communication from the department. Department writes you a letter. The most serious example is the recent ones where the departments wrote a letter to you, letter to some of the taxpayers, in fact, a large number, I am told, that there is a difference between the 2A, which is automatically filled by the department, by the portal, and your GST or one, that is the total ITC taken, you explain. Now many people have found it extremely difficult to explain, and it has started disputes. And there was a new rule which was introduced, rule 86A, which says specific things. As I was telling you earlier, the officers do not believe in following the law to the letter and spirit. They believe in trying to get more revenue, especially this year because they were behind the target. Next one is issue of shokan notice. All these things, issue of shokan notice is invariably definite commencement of dispute. Of course, we will come to the legal means where some help is available from the law itself to avoid disputes that we will be covering later. Actually, dispute resolution is something very important in all tax matters. In fact, if there are less disputes between the taxpayer and the tax collecting machinery, tax administration as a whole is considered more efficient. Of course, this is not one of the concerns in the Indian tax collecting machinery, but this is the general philosophy. Next one is dispute resolution is an important function of any tax administration. To avoid delays in resolving disputes, the administrative law, which empowers, which gives powers to the officers themselves to impose penalty, impose demand tax, was introduced. But this has become a weapon in the hands of officers. While it has reduced the burden on the courts, it has really affected the taxpayers, because quite often the demands, when they are confirmed, especially the excess experience in central excise, service tax, even in GST now, shows that once a dispute starts, invariably it will go to the highest level possible. Of course, we will be coming to the legal efforts made by government to reduce disputes. The image of the tax administration depends on how quickly and fairly the tax disputes are resolved and settled, not on how many disputes are created. This is the image. This is the philosophy of taxation. But in India, the tax administration doesn't give much. The impression is the tax administration doesn't care for this. But in reality, especially at senior levels, quite often when we discuss, we tell others, and we are also told that be fair, be reasonable, meet people, try to understand their difficulties. These are told. But how many implement is a different part altogether. An effective and efficacious dispute resolution mechanism would go a long way in encouraging and promoting voluntary tax compliance. Once you know that if there is a dispute, I will get a fair treatment, the litigation will automatically come down. And quite often, if the general public has confidence, the moment department officers tell that this is wrong, you have to pay, and people may pay. And if we want to attract foreign investment, effective and expeditious dispute resolution is a must. Now, this is the background. Now we come to, we have seen all these things. Now we have to see prevention of disputes. First, we will discuss legal provisions. Law itself has many provisions which will prevent, which are put there with an intention to prevent disputes or reduce disputes. First, we will take up Section 73, which must have already been covered, I am not very sure. But in Section 73, there are provisions. According to those provisions, if you pay the disputed amount with interest on your own, either on intimation by department or without intimation by department, then no Shokan notice will be issued if the amount paid is correct. If the amount paid is wrong, they will write a letter. If you pay the balance, matter ends there. Otherwise, a notice will be issued. Even after a notice is issued, if you feel that the notice is correct and you are liable to pay, if you make the payment within 30 days, then also, of course, it is to be paid with interest, then also no further proceedings will be taking place. This is the first provision in section 73. Then we come to section 74. Section 74 is for cases where there is suppression, fraud, misdeclaration, etc., and these are considered offense cases. Even in those cases, if you pay the tax, interest, and 15% towards penalty, 15% of the tax towards penalty, the law provides for no further dispute or show cause notice. Supposing you wait till show cause notice is issued, but you pay within 30 days of show cause notice because you feel you have no case, then also penalty will go up to 25%, but again no show cause, no further action. Even after the order is issued, if you pay the tax, interest, and 50% of the tax as penalty within 30 days of the order, again the matter will be considered as closed. Even though 100% tax has been imposed as penalty, if you pay 50% penalty and no further appeal is made, and the matter is closed. So these are provisions in the sections 73 and 74 to reduce disputes. This is the first legal provision which I am discussing. One by one I will be discussing the other provisions. Next provision is section 75. Now section 75 actually is a welcome measure in GST law, because many of the things which were basically judicial pronouncements but not part of the law have been incorporated here. Section 75 is for timely determination of tax. Now you see, unlike earlier, if the order is not passed within the period prescribed, that is 3 years from the due date for filing annual return in the case of no offense, that is normal period, and 5 years from the due date for filing annual return in the case of suppression, misdeclaration, etc., the order has to be passed within 3 years in the case of normal period and 5 years in the case of offense. If it is not passed, the proceedings are deemed to have been concluded. That means no further action can be taken by the department. Earlier, there were cases where a show cause notice is issued and department would not bother to adjudicate for years together. That situation has totally ended now. If the order is not passed within the period, no further action can be taken. This would have been covered in detail earlier, but this is one of the major steps taken by government to ensure timely resolution of dispute. If a dispute has been raised by department, it cannot go indefinitely at the original level. We come to the appeal and these things later, could have been covered separately, but original level there cannot be delay. The next one is, sometimes earlier what used to happen, the matter goes to the commissioner appeals or tribunal and is remanded back, saying that you re-examine the evidence or you hear the party again, whatever. There will be guidelines and order will be remanded. Thereafter, unless the party pursued many times the department never used to bother, especially in the case of refunds, etc. The party will be in a hurry to get the dispute resolved, but department will be in no hurry. But now they have provided that within 2 years, the issues where the remand has been passed have to be decided. The next one is, you cannot go beyond the show cause notice. Earlier also this was there, but basically in the nature of judicial guidelines, but now it has been incorporated in the law. Again, earlier order could be passed without detailed reasoning. Now the law says you have to pass with detailed reasons. These are some of the precautions which have been taken in section 75. Next we come to section 120. Section 120 is a very important section. In fact, a few years back, government came out with a national litigation policy. According to national litigation policy, government has to be an efficient and responsible litigant and not a compulsive litigant. In fact, in the introduction, when I told you that 80% of the cases where the government is in appeal, they lose, and 80% of the cases where parties are in appeal, they win, shows that government is a compulsive litigant. In fact, one problem with government litigation is, if you are sitting as an officer, you don't have to worry about payment to the advocate. Whereas for a taxpayer, it is a cost. Litigation is a cost. You have to pay the advocate, you have to prepare, you have to pay the fees. There are so many expenses involved. You have to meet the expenses for hearing. Whereas in the government, when you decide that an appeal has to be filed, the money is spent, but you are not responsible for the expenditure. You don't have to think where the money is going to come from. As a result, it is very easy for officers to take decisions to file appeal. What used to happen, in fact, what continued to happen, that is why this section 120 has come, is that the policy is refund if it has been allowed, file appeal. Demand if it has been dropped, file appeal. You don't have to, you find some reason and file appeal. This is the policy which was followed. As a result, dispute was increasing. So what they have done as a result of national litigation policy is, both CBDT, which is responsible for income tax, Central Board of Direct Taxes, and CBIC, which is responsible for indirect tax, have taken decisions. For example, in Central Excise, if it is more than 50 lakhs only, you can go to, department can file appeal before the tribunal. If it is 1 crore only, you can go to High Court. If it is more than 2 crores only, you can go to Supreme Court. This was the limit prescribed in Central Excise law. And in Section 120, a notification is yet to be issued. Therefore, we do not know what will be the limits which will be prescribed for monetary limits. So if the amount of tax involved, or the amount involved in terms of tax or penalty, is less than those amounts, no appeal will be filed. They cannot file appeal or application, whatever be the reason, whether you have a case or you have no case, nothing matters. You can't file appeal. So, of course, safeguards are provided to say that if an appeal has not been filed because of monetary limits, the decision not to file an appeal has no precedence value. Of course, in 120, we do not know what will be the monetary limits because notification is yet to be issued. Now there is another section 121. Of course, this is not exactly a favorable section for the taxpayers, but it prevents litigation. In the sense, it says there is a statutory bar for litigation. That is, no appeals can be filed by the taxpayer or by the department against orders where, supposing proceedings have been transferred from one officer to another. This cannot be questioned. Relating to seizure or retention of records or documents, you can't file appeal. Sanctioning prosecution, supposing commissioner is supposed to sanction prosecution, he has sanctioned or he has not sanctioned, no appeal can be filed. Similarly, section 80 provides for payment of arrears in installments and whether the installment payment is permitted or refused, no appeal. This is section 121. Four cases, no appeal. The decision is final. Section 126 is a protection for the taxpayers. This says this is general discipline while imposing penalty. This is the heading. That means it says for minor breaches, that is amount less than 5,000, no penalty. Then it also says penalty should be commensurate with the degree and severity of the breach. And it also says, that is why we were talking about intimation earlier. It also says voluntary disclosure. That means you have written a letter or you have informed the department. It has to be considered as a mitigating factor. While imposing penalty, he has to take into account that this party has intimated earlier. Therefore, the intention is not there, etc., etc. Then section 138. Prosecution has been sanctioned. It's going to be launched. And the party may have to go to jail because more than 5 crores punishment can go up to 7 years. So you don't want that. You feel department has a strong case. So you can pay the tax, penalty, and interest, and thereafter approach the department to compound the case. So commissioner will fix a compounding fee and say, okay, no prosecution. You pay the compounding fee after paying the tax and everything. That is the end of the matter. Compounding fee can vary from 10,000 to 1,50,000 and are equivalent to tax. Whichever is higher, the rules are there. So compounding fee, that is called compounding fee. You pay the compounding fee and tax, interest and penalty, which has already been imposed, end of the matter. This is a section which ends the second type of disputes, that is in the court. There are, as you know, in taxation law, there are two types of punishments. One is the departmental adjudication, where seized goods may be confiscated, fine may be imposed, tax will be demanded, interest will be demanded, penalty will be imposed, but there will be no imprisonment and there will be no proceedings in the court. That proceedings in the court also can happen, and there is no double jeopardy in this case according to law. Therefore, the second dispute also can be prevented. If you have not been able to prevent the first dispute, second dispute also, even then you can try to get the second dispute prevented. The next one is compliance rating. It is section 149. It is yet to be implemented. We don't know the norms, but as I told earlier, this will reward knowledge, compliance with the law, your attitude to the taxation. It will reward these things. The compliance rating is high, the periodicity of audit will come down, inspection, search, seizure, they may think twice. There will be advantages. Therefore, we have to start preparing for getting a higher compliance. That can happen by doing things properly correctly in time and ensuring that we follow the law to the letter and the spirit. And the reward in the form of a higher compliance rating and in the form of a better treatment by the tax department will be coming. So this will prevent, this will naturally reduce disputes. The next one is rectification of errors. Sometimes what happens is, while passing the order, mistakes are committed. If they are clerical mistakes or they are apparent from the records, you need not file an appeal. You need not take the dispute further. The concerned officer himself can be approached, and he has the power to correct. He has the power to rectify the error. Then we come to advance ruling. Advance ruling, I have already discussed very briefly earlier. It is supposed to help in getting to know what exactly is the correct position. And here only two levels of disputes are there. First is you go to the advance ruling authority, then there is an appeal. But unfortunately, it has not worked well. It has not really fulfilled the expectations either of the taxpayers or of the department. Now, we have finished the legal provisions. Now we come to taxpayers. What you can do to reduce disputes? First and foremost is the one where you know the law, a thorough knowledge of law. Unfortunately, in our country, we think the law is very difficult to understand, and we don't even try. I feel that with some amount of time spent on studying the law and understanding the procedure and understanding the process will be of great help, especially in view of the complications that can happen if a dispute starts, if a mistake is made. Therefore, a good knowledge of law is extremely helpful. And everything I do, everything the taxpayer or an employee of the taxpayer does, he should know why he is doing, how he is doing. One is studying it yourself. The second is attending training programs. The third is talking to people who may know. Again, I had already discussed earlier, the consultants, advocates, there are so many. But the problem is identifying a person who is impartial, who is fair, who will give you correct advice is also important. Of course, this is also difficult to do. Quite often, it goes by word of mouth, because the advocates are chartered accountants, professionals, they are not supposed to advertise. Therefore, you have to go by word of mouth, or you have to go by your experience, or you have to and try to find ways and means of finding a good person. So thorough knowledge of law is important. Then you have to make sincere effort to be legally compliant. It is not enough if we know the law. Efforts are also required to ensure that we are legally compliant. Quite often, nowadays, many big companies have a system of appointing a compliance officer. Now, it's a good idea to do it. The compliance officer should be the one with a good knowledge of law, and he should know whenever there is a complication or whenever there is a process procedure, he should know whether you are complying with it. So for this, he will need wide powers. He should have access to the process and procedures and the work of the concerned officers. If you appoint a complaints officer, but he doesn't have power to look anywhere, only when it is referred to him, he should see. It may not be enough. He should be able to find out what's happening. He should be able to be proactive. He cannot be only react. He has to be proactive. So this kind of things, if you do, and if he also checks that whether you are legally compliant, in addition to the fact that the officers are yours, the taxpayer, have a thorough knowledge of law and want to be legally compliant, I think the job is done. Now, the next thing is, okay, you do all this, but even then, strong internal control is a must. For example, there are many cases where internal control is a must. In fact, it is suggested quite often, it is suggested that you should have a operating procedure, standard operating procedure for everything. For example, you take classification. How a classification of a new product that you are coming out or a new service that you are going to give has to be done. How do you determine it? How do you determine what should be the rate of tax on it? How do you assess it? There should be standard operating procedure. That means these will be checked by the, for example, compliance officer will check whether you have done it correctly. For that, the system is important. The system should say, for example, if you say classification, there should be a note prepared explaining what exactly is the item, what is the heading, why it goes under that heading, whether it is a composite service or a mixed service. If it is a composite service, what is the principal service? Why it is a principal service? If it is a mixed service, why it is a mixed supply? All these things have to come. And in that way, the government has a beautiful system. There are two parts in a file. One is a notes part, another one is a correspondence part. In the notes part, officers write why a particular thing is done, how it is done, and what is the conclusion. This is not there in the industry. Somebody takes a decision, tomorrow you don't know how it was done. A strong internal control where there is a process and the procedure to determine helps you not only to do things correctly, but also to convince the departmental officers when the occasion demands that your intention was good. You had no intention to evade the tax. You try to do things legally and correctly. This can be done when you have a system and a process, and that process is followed. And if there is a defect in the process, that can be corrected. For example, another example of internal control is you have to make payment to the supplier. Originally, earlier, it was not required. You have to see whether the supplier is tolerating. Anytime you pay, he will keep quiet. Then he is a very good supplier. You will not bother. But now, if you are taking input tax credit and the supply is received from him, you have to necessarily ensure that the payment is made within 180 days. If it is not made, ITC taken is reversed. All these things are required. So this is where strong internal control comes into picture. So if there are no strong internal controls, even a compliance officer may not be able to do much. Therefore, a strong internal control coupled with other three things which I told earlier can help a lot in preventing disputes. The next step is a strong and effective internal audit. The internal audit department has to have some expertise, has to have at least one person who is an expert in indirect tax. So when they audit the indirect tax, they should be able to find out what are the problems. This will be in addition to the compliance officer, and this will be like a postmortem. But if there are mistakes, they can find out, and they should be able to find out. Of course, if you don't have a very strong internal audit, or if you feel that it is necessary, it's always better to have a strong and effective professional audit at least once in a year or once in 2-3 years, depending upon your ability to spend money and complications, etc., etc. It is always good to have a strong and effective professional audit at least once. Now in the case of GST, it is necessary to do it at least once, so that whatever you are doing, where you are making mistakes, because audits have already started, departmental audits have already started, but before they come to you, if you can get an audit, professional audit done on GST, you may come to know what are the mistakes you have made, and automatically you may be able to rectify them and avoid disputes. Then of course, utilization of legal provisions to reduce and prevention of disputes. I already explained what are the legal provisions. So these legal provisions have to be used to reduce and prevent disputes. Then regular consultation, it's always better to get professional advice, especially even when the department audit takes place. It is not that everything should be accepted to avoid disputes. Sometimes it may be worthwhile doing undertaking disputes. Then utilization of various forum to give grievances and get them rectified. It is not that if you have a grievance, you should always be able to go to a higher level and approach them to get the dispute resolved. Then mitigation. I already told you, use of section 73, 5 and 8 and 74, which are basically paying the taxes, and cost benefit analysis before taking action. You have to make a cost. Sometimes it may be necessary to go into dispute, because it may be more beneficial to go into dispute rather than accepting the liability. The liability is very high. Naturally, you would like to go. So therefore, a cost benefit analysis has to be made before taking a decision to adopt, whether either to prevent dispute or to go all the way, where exactly we should end. And effective correspondence with the department. Many times, private, especially private companies and taxpayers, don't have the system of having correspondence file, maintaining records. It's very important, especially with government, to do everything in writing, to have evidence for everything done. Then effective use of RTI. You make an application, nothing happens. You write another letter, nothing happens. Then representation, that is RTI Act, right to inform
your participants. I think there is a technical issue. We'll resolve it in another 2 minutes.
Established. I'll go back,
sir. Now it is audible. I think okay. you can start mitigation this one, sir.
Yes, I'll start. Okay, we'll start. Then next, we were talking about RTI Act, Right to Information Act. That is another one, a weapon, you should use it, because it is quite effective. In fact, you can't ask the department why you have not acted. What you have to do is you have to write a letter saying that I have made a request like this, kindly do this or whatever it is. Thereafter, after 1 month, you can ask for the copy of the file where my letter has been dealt with. That will show what action has been taken. Because in government, every letter that comes, your file has to be opened, it has to be acted upon. So you will come to know what action has been taken and pursue it. This is one way of using it. This is a good idea to use RTA. Next one is interaction with senior officers. When you have a problem with a junior officer, it is always better to meet the senior officers. Quite often people don't meet, and this is a problem. And you have to meet. You need not be afraid. You take an appointment and meet. If he doesn't meet, meet the next higher level. Then next one is representation to the officers and government. Keep making a representation. There is no harm in making request. If you have a problem, make a request. Definitely, if there is no response, again RTA will help. Then effective use of writ remedies. Writ is a facility. The court will require an officer to act or not to act, depending upon what the law requires. If an officer is not following the law and it is affecting you quite a lot and you don't mind the cost, then writ remedy is a good method. So you should know these are all the areas where remedies are available. The next one, the last one, is use of PG portal, public grievance portal. This government has started a public grievance portal. You go there and give a complaint. They have to give a reply within 2 months. This is what it says. And I was told, and I am told it is true also, that this is monitored by the Prime Minister's office. As a result, almost every department takes it very seriously. Therefore, you can use this portal also to air your grievance and get a solution. I think with this, I come to the end of the session, and you are welcome to ask questions if you have any. And thank you very much for listening to me patiently. And sorry for the disturbance in the middle, which could not be helped. Thank you very much.
Yes. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much, sir. I'll be asking you questions. There are a couple of questions. Apart from that, I request participants, the PPT has been uploaded in the website, so you can go through it. If you get any questions at that time also, you can just mail us as to, we will answer through the mail only. Sir, the first question I will take. Murthy sir, it's audible, right, sir?
Audible.
First question I'll take, sir. What is the course of remedy if the officer has raised the demand which during the earlier oral communication officer himself had told that there would be no demand in the same situation, same facts and same law? I think you have already dealt it, but you can just throw a light upon it and some any comments on this.
That is why I said earlier that when they tell you orally that okay, there will be no demand, you always request for the demand in writing. Anything with the government should always be in writing, number one. Number two, there is no estoppel in law. If an officer in the department, even if he gives it to you in writing that you are not liable, department can still raise a demand. The demand within the normal period can always be raised irrespective of the fact that the department officer has said there will be no demand. Leave alone oral, even in writing. Therefore, it is the if the officer makes a oral demand, ask for it in writing. And when he writes, you have to give a reply. And if there is no case, while giving reply, try to give as detailed or a correct reply. This is the only solution.
Okay, sir. I think the question has been addressed sufficiently in detail. I'll take up the next question. What course of action can be taken other than appeal if the officer rejects or threatens claim that refund with refund without understanding the law or without looking into the submission? They're asking, apart from going for appeal, how can we get the refund if the officer is denying it?
Once a refund application has been filed, and if the officer says you are not eligible orally, that is not valid. If he tries to tell you separately that no, you are not eligible for refund, you should always ask that kindly give me a show cause notice. He has to give a show cause notice for rejection and thereafter you have to get a chance to reply, and he has to pass an order. He cannot delay the refund and he cannot postpone the refund payment. That's all you can do. And if he passes an order, the only remedy to go in appeal. There is nothing much anybody can do once a dispute is started by the department. Only thing is, when you are filing the refund, give the grounds of the refund correctly. See that the documentation requirements are fulfilled. See that when he writes a letter or receives a show cause notice, reply is prepared properly. Otherwise, there is nothing much you can do about it. These are cases where you have to fight legally. There's nothing much you can do about it if they start the dispute, because here the dispute is started by the department and you cannot really do anything except take the steps to file appeal, etc. And if an officer is continuously doing it to many people, then of course all of you can represent as an association. It is always another good thing to do, which I forgot to mention. If you have an association can represent that this officer is doing this, he is passing orders like this, he is doing this. When association represents, no individual assessee will be targeted. Therefore, association can also complain against an officer, saying that he is not properly behaving, he is not doing the things which he is required to do according to law, etc., etc. They can always represent and take it up. And many times I find that in India, these associations are not used effectively by their members. Many times, if you have a problem, if 2-3 people have a problem, go to the association and tell them that please represent. Quite often, what we do is, when there are complaints against an officer, when I was in the department also, we used to do it, and invariably department does it. When there is a complaint, we take the officer out. Quite often, if nothing happens, at least he gets transferred. These are the only solutions that are possible.
Okay, I think it was answered in detail. I'll take up the next question, sir. GST officers are giving notices under Section 68 and attaching bank directly, bank account. In such cases, what can the client do? In many cases, the clients are coming only after knowing the bank details or bank accounts are attached.
There's nothing much you can do except, one is you can go to High Court, which many people have done. Go to High Court, and High Courts invariably intervene if it is not done in accordance with law. Otherwise, as I told you, make the association go and represent to the government. If it is state government, if the state officer, go and represent to state government. If it is a central government, go and represent to the CBIC or to his senior officer. Quite often, if somebody is doing unnecessarily against 2-3 people, or if there are other demands, naturally you can definitely represent. But once the attachment is done, there is very little you can do. One thing is, you can go and request him, because invariably what happens is, when you go to court will first ask, have you taken the legal remedy? Therefore, the moment he attaches, first thing to do is, to next day you write a letter to him and to his bosses, everybody, that this is not correct and this is not legal. Then if he done, you say, kindly respond and we are in trouble and this will happen, that will happen. Then if he doesn't reply, you can go to court. Because quite often when you go to court will say, have you given representation to him? So that will be, by giving representation immediately, by the time you prepare to file the writ petition, the representation would have been either replied or not replied. In both cases, you will be able to justify. The only remedy is writ remedy, which is strictly costly, but then if the amount is big, you can do it. Otherwise, keep representing and keep talking. That's all.
Okay, sir. Then we are at the end of this session. I thank Murthy sir for his valuable time providing for the academy and enhancing our knowledge. I request all participants to go through the PPT. And again, you can, if you have any queries, you can mail us. This will be sorted out through the mail. The replies will be sent through the mail. Thank you very much, Murthy sir, for joining us for the session.
Welcome. Thank you very much. Thanks to all the participants, and goodbye.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.